Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Committee on the Scottish Government Handling of Harassment Complaints. Our first item of business is a decision to take our work programme discussion at item 4 in private. Can I invite members to agree? Thank you very much. And that brings us to our second item of business, which is an evidence session on the judicial review phase of our inquiry. May I remind all those present and watching that we are bound by the terms of our remit and the relevant court orders, including the need to avoid contempt of court by identifying certain individuals, including through jigsaw identification. The committee as a whole has also agreed that it is not our role to revisit events that were a focus of the trial that could be seen to constitute a rerun of the criminal trial. Our remit is to consider and report on the actions of the First Minister, Scottish Government officials and special advisers in dealing with complaints about Alex Salmond, former First Minister, considered under the Scottish Government's handling of harassment complaints involving current or former ministers and procedures and actions in relation to the Scottish Ministerial Code. The more we get into specifics of evidence, the more we run the risk of identifying those who made complaints. And the more we ask about specific matters covered in the trial, including events explored in the trial, the more we run the risk of rerunning that trial. Wherever possible, can witnesses, as well as members, please avoid discussion of the specifics of concerns or complaints, and also avoid naming specific government officials under senior civil service level. Can members please ensure when asking a question on a particular government record to give the document reference and also the footnote reference to the government witness for their ease of reference? Finally, the Scottish Government has asserted legal privilege over many documents on the judicial review. May I remind the witness that the Deputy First Minister made clear in his letter of 14th August, and I quote, "This position need not impede the committee's inquiry. It does not prevent Scottish Government witnesses from explaining in detail to the committee in their evidence what the Scottish Government's legal position was at various points." The Lord Advocate indicated in his submission to the committee, and I repeat this intention here, that the Scottish Government will be happy to give a full account of its legal position at different points in time in relation to areas of interest to the committee. That was the Deputy First Minister in his letter of 14th August. The committee therefore expects a full account today, and where legal privilege is asserted on any details, we would appreciate the grounds for this to be set out clearly. With that, may I welcome Paul Coquette, former Director of Legal Services, Scottish Government. And I begin by inviting Mr. Coquette to take the oath. If you would raise your right hand, please, Mr. Coquette, and repeat after me. I swear by Almighty God.
I swear by Almighty God.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you. I now invite Mr. Coquette to make a brief opening statement.
Yes, Mr. Coquette. Good morning, Convener. Good morning, committee members. Since 26 March 2020, I've been redeployed on COVID-related work, initially on organisational readiness and then on temporary promotion as Director PPE from 10th April to 26th June, and since 26th June as Director Outbreak Management. My current formal role is the Chief Planning Reporter, which is a post I've held since August 2016, after 7 years as Deputy Solicitor in SGLD. I was appointed as Director of Legal Services as Head of SGLD on an interim basis on the 8th of May 2018, and held that post until 14th June 2019. SGLD sit within the DG Constitution and External Affairs family within the Scottish Government. The Director General there is and was at the relevant time Ken Thompson. In that period, I was responsible as head of SGLD to the law officers for all the legal advice given at that time and for the management of the directorate of directorate-related matters. And thus, I was responsible for all SGLD advice in that period, for the running of SGLD and for its financial and people management responsibilities. And obviously I'll try to answer all questions as I can in relation to those aspects and other questions of the committee. You've indicated, Convener, already the position as far as the LPP, which I needn't repeat. I'll endeavour to answer detailed questions on the conduct of litigation as well as I can from my own recollection and the emails retained by me from that period, subject to that. but I obviously wasn't directly involved in every single aspect of the case, nor copied into every email. Where I'm unable to provide a sufficiently detailed answer for the committee, and where that can be done without breaching LPP, answers will be provided in writing in a way consistent with the letter from the Deputy First Minister of 14th October. And I'm very happy to return to the committee if it feels it would be helpful for me to do so, if any further questions arise from that. Lastly, I should declare that since 2012, I've been the Scottish Government nominated officer for compliance with the Civil Service Code. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Cricket. I now move to committee members who wish to ask questions. And I go first to Alistair Allen, who's joining us remotely. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Kavira. I wonder if you could say a bit more, Mr. Cricket, please, firstly about the extent of the role that you had personally in decision-making around this case, and particularly to whom you reported in making those decisions.
Catch the very last bit of that question, particularly on the...
Can I ask you what your role was in making decisions around this case and to whom you reported?
OK, right, thank you. Yes, my role, as I said in my opening statement, was as the was senior lawyer within the legal directorate, and I had a general overseeing role in relation to this case to ensure that the advice given to the permanent secretary initially in relation to the operation of the procedure from when I was appointed until the final decision was made was to the highest professional quality. And then after the decision was reached by the permanent secretary and then matters were referred in consistent with the procedure to the First Minister and other ministers, I then was responsible for providing advice to the course of the judicial review right up until its conclusion. That involved the coordination of a number of areas of SGLD advice, partly and primarily in relation to the operation of the procedure and how it applied in the particular circumstances, but also in the management of the litigation itself. We have a number of divisions within SGLD with different responsibilities, some subject matter responsibilities, and there was one division advising on matters relating to employment law, and therefore they had the kind of the overarching responsibility, if you like, the SGLD policy lead, and they worked with the litigation team, who became involved, but actually only became involved because of the confidentiality of the issues prior to that. They only became involved at the stage when the judicial review was intimated as being about to be served. So it was basically those two divisions were involved, and my role was to ensure a coordination and the confidence from me reporting to the Lord Advocate on the advice on the substance and on the handling and running of the judicial review.
Can I ask in that case if you're able to make any kind of comparison with other judicial reviews? I'm aware that the government has to deal typically with many judicial reviews. Can I ask, are you able to make any comparison as to whether the spend on this case was typical or atypical?
I suppose that there's two differences from what you might regard as a typical judicial review. There was no doubt that my role as being the director involved a greater level of involvement in this than a kind of typical run-of-the-mill judicial review. It's not unique because sometimes the director takes a close involvement in that. So it was different in that respect. In terms of expenditure, from the legal directorate's perspective, I think it's fair to say that we did involve probably a larger number of lawyers were involved in different aspects because of its multifaceted nature than most judicial reviews. Our costs generally were again not wholly untypical in the sense that we'd instructed senior counsel We do instruct senior counsel, obviously, for the most important of cases, including those that go to the Supreme Court. But I would say the majority of litigation that the government conducts is conducted by our panel of junior counsel, who deal with, as I say, most cases, and that involves, obviously, because it's one counsel rather than two, a lower amount of expenditure. So from my point of view, it was more expensive, but given the profile of the case, not standing out any more than, say, a Supreme Court case would be.
And finally, can I ask, I appreciate it's difficult to make comparisons for the reasons you've given, but given the number of cases of judicial review that the government deals with, how typical or atypical is it for a case to be considered? And can you say a bit more about that, the comparisons that might be made with other cases on that?
With the government actually, happily, for the SG, actually loses a relatively small number of cases. The vast majority are won, and certainly the consequences of losing are very significant, as can be seen, well, not only obviously here, but in other cases where the implications are significant. In terms of numbers of cases that we would concede in advance, again, it's pretty rare. But I would say that, as I said in my opening statement, that my role, not as a lawyer, but is as chief planning reporter, and in the planning context is one that I'm kind of most familiar with. We have conceded cases. I wouldn't like to put a percentage figure on it. And indeed, I was conscious of one case 3 years ago where I looked at the decision we'd made and I decided, even though it hadn't been appealed and wasn't due to be appealed, that it was unsustainable because the reporter had gone so wrong, and offered to the other side, if they appealed, we wouldn't oppose that. And it would be set aside with expenses against us. So in the planning context, I'm not trying to suggest planning is any worse than anywhere else, we do concede cases from time to time because we look at it, and we will look at, as in my experience specifically, is in the planning context, and we have sometimes looked at cases and said this can't be supported, and we'd concede a case in those circumstances.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. Can I move now to Margaret Mitchell?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Cacquet. Were you aware the former First Minister had suggested arbitration as a means to settle competency and legality of the procedure?
I'm looking to the Convener here. I think I could answer that question in light of some earlier issues in relation to privilege, and she's nodding, so I'm thinking that's a yes. So the answer is yes, it was.
Okay. And who made you aware of this, and did your department, were they involved in discussions about the decision to reject arbitration?
Yes, I became aware of this proposal about arbitration from lawyer-to-lawyer correspondence, which was around June 2018. I came into post in May 8, 2018, and I knew there'd been a previous suggestion of mediation for my time, and then the suggestion of arbitration came, as I remember, around June.
And were you involved in discussions to reject on the basis of?
I was involved in my discussion on the basis as legal advisor at that point, it was also something that I was aware of in terms of the kind of the pros and cons of arbitration as a potential way forward from a previous policy job that I'd done.
But why didn't you think it was suitable and should be rejected in the judicial review? It was about competency and legality of the procedure.
Well, I'm not sure I can answer the question about the... I'll be able to answer the question about the legal advice given, but what I can set out is the Scottish Government position, the policy position, if you like, in relation to the rejection of arbitration, if that'd be helpful.
So you weren't asked your view and you didn't proffer a view?
The directorate gave a view.
And that was on what basis? To reject this, on what basis?
It was rejected on a range of reasons. The view that we'd taken was that at a general level, arbitration was something that could be open to dispute resolution and resolution of, if you like, technical or legal issues that were outstanding, where the parties had a desire and an incentive for a quick resolution of an issue of a technical nature, but it is not generally regarded as being an appropriate means of resolving a dispute where there is a significant degree of factual disagreement in relation to particular harassment type.
Can I stop you there?
Of course.
Arbitration had nothing to do with the substantive complaints. It was purely on the procedure, its competency and legality. Why was that rejected and why did you think it should be rejected?
The view that we took was that it wasn't possible to completely separate out the substance of the complaints from the arguments about procedural regularity or irregularity, because the circumstances and the nature of the complaints themselves and the fairness of that
procedure.
But it
wasn't about the complaints, it was about the procedure. Didn't need to go into the complaints at all. Arbitration doesn't. It was quite clear, and Mr. Salmond made it quite clear in his views, both in emails to the First Minister and in his letters to his solicitors, that this was on the legal basis, competency and legality of the procedure.
And we took the view that it wasn't possible ultimately to separate these things out, or if it had been, then the issue about the substance of the complaints would not have been resolved through that arbitration process. And then the suggestion that would have in some ways avoided a later challenge in judicial review, it didn't seem to be us to be correct.
Perhaps we can make more progress, Convener, if I ask you, Mr. Cacquet, about the expenses which were paid on an agent and client basis, a scale the court has discretion to apply where one of the parties has conducted litigation incompetently or unreasonably. Yeah. And I have to say, from your last order, your last answer, that perhaps is not unsurprising. Can you outline the heads, as mentioned by the Lord Advocate, that justified this highest of all legal scales?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly seemed to us that the nature of the way in which the litigation was had been required to be resolved, and that was because of the way in which the interactions that the investigating officer had with the complainers and the timings of how that had arisen and the way in which it took through the specification of documents and then on to the stages where a commission and diligence was required was something that I think we'd made it quite difficult to say that this in that respect was kind of, you like, normal litigation. In my experience, the commission and diligence, specifications of documents are relatively common. Commissions and diligence, I've never come across before. So I've never come across a situation where a petitioner, in effect, was forced to go into that situation where they not only served the commission and diligence, but that it proceeded in the way that it did. And so it certainly seemed to me, whatever adjective you choose to describe it, it certainly seemed to me to be very difficult to say, given the way events had panned out, that it would be wrong to have allowed the higher level expenditure on behalf of the petitioners.
That sounded a bit complicated. Perhaps you can write to the committee
once
you've had a chance to think about this and explain precisely the heads that justified the expenses being paid on that basis. Finally, Convener, I wonder if the total cost associated with the judicial review was £630,000 of taxpayers' money, and that included the net cost of external legal fees incurred by the Scottish Government in defending the judicial review. That came to £118,523. Can you break down how this sum was arrived at?
Oh, I'm sorry, I don't have, again, I can write with the detail of that insofar as I can. I don't know the precise details of of how it had broken down in terms of council's cost, I'm guessing you're referencing.
Well, I wonder if you could confirm, obviously included the cost of senior and junior council.
Yes, indeed.
Are you aware of any other costs incurred by legal services that was part of that £118,523?
There were other legal costs involved through other other agents that had been involved, other legal agents that were involved from the Scottish Government perspective of the cost that we incurred. I don't know if it's counted in the 100,000, but obviously there was costs a little bit harder to calculate what they are in time sense of the legal time that was incurred by members of my directorate. I mean, I guess you could make an estimate of that, and we could sit down and work out how many hours individual lawyers spent doing things and top that up to get an overall global cost. But that isn't normally collated as we go. We don't time record in that sense, if that's what your question is.
But you can write back to the committee on how the 118...
Yes, I'm sure we can do that, yes.
That would be very much appreciated. Thank you.
Of course.
Thank you, Mr. Kickett. Alistair Allen has indicated he's a supplementary question before I move on. Alistair Allen.
Thank you very much, Convener. The Deputy Convener asked there about some of the reasons for declining the offer of arbitration. In a letter, which I think the committee has just released, the 9th of July 2018, from the former First Minister's legal team to the Permanent Secretary, that letter indicates that one of the arguments on offer was that arbitration would avoid, quote, propelling the matter into the public domain. Can I ask, would it be normal to take a request based on an argument of that kind into consideration one way or another in making a decision about whether to accept such an offer?
I mean, it could potentially be a factor in that respect. I mean, that was my understanding of one of the reasons why it was being proposed. And obviously, we knew then when those decisions were made. What subsequently transpired as the course of what became the judicial review then proceeded. Then obviously the case was conceded. We didn't obviously know at the time of that correspondence that it would go to JR and we'd lose it. But at that time, it was certainly one of the factors. To me. As I was trying to indicate earlier on, the kind of as important a factor as that, although it plays into it, as important a factor as that is the question of how long an arbitration would have taken to have been resolved. And again, going back to the deputy convener's questions in that respect, I would have said it probably would have taken quite a long time to have resolved who the arbiter was going to be, and I know we're disagreeing about the remit. I suspect it would have taken a little bit of time to work out what the remit would be in drawing lines to protect the anonymity of the complainers, and that would have been absolutely fine if everyone had an incentive in order to get an earlier resolution of this. But I'm not sure that this is necessarily in the set of circumstances that arbitration is designed for, where both sides want a quick and ready resolution of legal dispute. I don't think we viewed it in that way. And if that had led to the situation, if it had taken quite a long time, and it, you know, as I say, it could have taken a really quite a long time, if somebody wanted to drag it out, it would take a potentially quite a long time, and that would play into the question about the maintaining confidentiality until the end of it would potentially have led to a situation where the government might have found itself then accused of covering this up if it maintained that confidentiality for a period longer than was reasonable. So there was all sorts of kind of pros and cons and hazards about agreeing to a process that would have kept this out of the public domain, where we weren't sure at that point, and we'll never know, how long it would have taken to agree all these things and get the arbiter to make a decision. And as I said earlier also, there'd be no guarantee it wouldn't still have ended up in court, because as the Deputy Convener says, if we had found a way to exclude the substantive matters and the factual matters, there's every chance that the former First Minister would have still taken us to court on those aspects. So we didn't know that at that time. But I wouldn't have said it was necessarily a quicker way to resolve this, and would not have been a way that would avoid a court action.
Is that you, Mr. Allen? Yeah.
Thank you.
Go on now to Alex Cole Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Cackett. I'd like to follow up on the arbitration. And in your answer to Alistair Allen just now, you suggested that at the time that arbitration was suggested by the former First Minister, the government was unaware of a potential plan to take this to judicial review, or that you, then you would lose it. Is that...
Well, no, we're unaware that we're going to lose it. I'm only making that point. It was quite clear from the beginning, from what had been said to us, from, I think, the earliest correspondence at the start of March, that through Mr. Salmon's lawyers, they were indicating that they had a series of concerns about procedural irregularity, and were indicating that, you know, that they were very much minded, if it hadn't been resolved, to take this to court.
So there's a WhatsApp exchange between Alex Salmond and Nicola Sturgeon on the 7th of June, in an extensive message, this is supplied in the First Minister's evidence, in an extensive message, the former First Minister refers to multiple offers of arbitration. Yeah. He also refers to his own senior counsel's advice that were he to take it to judicial review, this would be a slam dunk for the former First Minister. Yeah. So all of this is flying around and would have been a factor. Can I ask... at that time, when the offer of arbitration was on the table, at any point to your knowledge, were the complainers made aware of this? Were they made aware, first and foremost, that there was a question around the legal competence of the investigation, and that there were these two routes that could be taken to resolve that competence?
I think the complainers knew there was correspondence, had an issue been raised that was challenging the competence of the procedure. I wasn't directly involved in... There was a kind of narrow line of communication. My understanding is no, they didn't. They were asked about mediation.
No, I know, but we don't want to confuse those.
But let's keep them very much separate.
Not.
As I understand, not about arbitration.
So they weren't told about that as an alternative to judicial review?
Yeah, that's my understanding.
And tell me, had a legally binding arbitration determined, as the judicial review did, that the process was unlawful, could the government have then considered the complaints again? Could they have had a whole do-over with new people, perhaps a revised process? Because it wasn't in the public domain, it seems to me that the government might have been able to undertake those complaints again.
Yes, I think that's right. And indeed now the situation is that the complaints, because this process was ultimately set aside by a court, the complaints, you know, if you like, I wouldn't say only technically, because I don't know what could happen. The complaints are not yet addressed.
So that's absolutely accurate. But given the winner-take-all nature of a judicial review and the public media circus around it, it is highly unlikely that because of that, those complaints will ever see the light of day through a government process again.
Well, I can't say that.
It's a rhetorical question. I'll move on. I'd like to talk about the legal advice. Now, we understand, and we've heard at the top of the meeting, that the government is citing legal privilege, but you are allowed to talk about the legal position.
Yes,
legal advice and legal position may be different, and I'd like to ask about that particularly. So not asking what the legal advice contained, but did the government legal position at any point deviate from the legal advice?
Sorry, did the government's position
legal strategy that the government deployed, did it ever deviate from the legal advice that it retained? So it was always commensurate with the legal advice?
It was informed by the legal advice, and I'm thinking about whether there was any difference between what the government did and the legal advice.
I'll give you a hypothetical. If the legal advice is don't do it, don't engage in the judicial review, and you engaged in the judicial review, that would be a deviation between... the advice the strategy of government.
I can't think of any examples where that happened.
Okay, that's fine. Can I ask, there was a lot of pressure at the time. Yeah. Did everyone sort of receive the legal advice in unison? Did they all agree that that made sense, or was there ever dissent?
From ministers?
From ministers, from the Lord Advocate, from the Permanent Secretary.
Well, I can't answer in relation to the Lord Advocate because that gets too much into the legal advice. No, there was no dissent, and not a suggestion of saying, we're not willing to accept this advice or anything of that sort of nature. No, nobody, certainly nobody, from my perspective at least, nobody said to me, I'm not accepted that advice, or go away and rethink it.
I'm struck by your setting aside the Lord Advocate in that.
No, I don't mean set aside. I just mean because that comes into the source and content of advice.
And you can't tell us why. Okay. Did the Permanent Secretary and the Lord Advocate always agree on the steps that the government should take in the conduct of this judicial review?
There was no question of any disagreement on the kind of core legal advice. I mean, the core legal advice would be framed in terms of what would get you into illegality. What could you not do? How could you know? At what point would it no longer be appropriate to defend the proceedings? And of course, we got to that stage, and the proceedings were then conceded. The reason I phrased my answer in that sense, in that way, is because the legal advice properly taken, as it was done throughout, informs effectively policy choices. And when there's a range of policy choices that are open to ministers, and there's many legal ways to proceed that are obviously ministerial discretions. The law doesn't determine what ministers do. Ministers have a range of policy options within the range of things which are legal. Now, some of those things involve higher risk than others, so not saying the laws are relevant in that, but our view would be if there's a range of things you can't do because it's illegal, and in the Parliament terms, that might breach ECHR, for example, if we see... So there's places you can't go. But within the range of where you can go, there's a series of choices. And each involves risk, some of which is legal risk, but some of which might be other sorts of risk.
And as with all policy choices, there are tensions.
Yeah, absolutely.
And with all policy choices that involve risk, there are heightened tensions. Did those tensions ever cause anybody to threaten to resign?
Not that I'm aware of. In terms of any kind of ministerial or official basis.
Okay. I've got some more questions, Convener, but I'm quite happy to let others come in first, and I'll come in at the end if that's okay.
Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Convener.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Cackett. Just before I go on to my question, can I just follow up Mr. Colhamilton's last question?
Yes, Chris, yeah.
You said nobody threatened to resign at the ministerial or official level. Yeah. Did council threaten to resign?
Communications between us and council and source and content of that, I'm afraid, are within the context of LPP. So I should have made that point clearer to Mr. Cole Hamilton.
Okay, thank you. That's a very interesting answer. Can I pursue issues around the detail and the progress of the judicial review?
Yes, of course.
I mean, just to put this into context, I mean, we know that the Scottish Government chose to defend the judicial review. We know that case was then conceded. We know, and the Deputy Convener has referred to this, that the award of expenses made to Mr. Salmon was done at the highest level, and that would normally be done in the case of a defence being either unreasonable or incompetent, which is a quite striking description. So we know it went wrong, and we know that the taxpayer had to pay £500,000 to Mr. Salmon. So something went wrong here, and something actually went catastrophically wrong. And I think what we're trying to do as a committee is understand how this came about. Now, we know Mr. Salmon had taken Council's opinion on his prospects of success. So can I ask, did the Scottish Government commission Council's opinion?
We'd commissioned Council from the stage when the investigation by the investigating officer was underway. So from then on, we'd instructed counsel opinion. When a finding was made, there was a cause for concern. We had counsel, senior, junior right. counsel from then, and then we had those counsel through to the end. And at various points in particular, including in the judicial review, I think as Lord Advocate has indicated, the prospects of success was constantly kept under review, including all the advice from all people involved in all of that.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I'll come on to the detailed time.
Yes, of course.
I think that's quite important. But just so I'm clear, when Mr. Salmon initially intimated his judicial review claim, was counsel's opinion externally taken at that point?
I mean, counsel had been involved from before, counsel's views were reflected in the answers that were lodged and in the conduct of the judicial review after that, which is reflected in the open record, which I think is one of the documents the committee has.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. And what assessment did the Scottish Government and its counsel make at that point of the prospects of success of the judicial review?
At that stage, the position was that the it was proper to defend the proceedings because on the basis of the arguments that were placed that were set out in the petition.
Okay, I'm not.
So the
answer it was proper to defend. I mean,
we're in a position where we thought the case. Was winnable and it would have been won, standing that litigation is always unpredictable. You could never absolutely say for any circumstances. But we're in that position where it was...
So there was an arguable case to defend?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. We now know that there was information that was not available or was not disclosed until later in the process.
Sure.
Why was that failure? Why was the legal position of the Scottish Government not informed by that information that subsequently came to light in November?
I only became aware of that information in the course of the judicial review proceedings, as the information was emerging, and indeed at Council too were in that position. And so the process and procedure that was being applied and the grounds that were taken by Mr. Salmond in the judicial review when initially raised, obviously didn't reference that because it only became clear in the later process through the specification of documents that we'll come to. And it was only through that the significance of that came into play. And obviously you've seen the initial written statement of Scottish Government that was provided earlier, at paragraph 39, that sets out the circumstances of why the case was conceded, and indeed the most recent timeline as well, indicates, I think this also reflects what Lord Advocate said in his notice, that the decision to settle reflected the conclusion based on the review of the material which had then become available. And that was the key thing against there, that the judicial review should be conceded for the reasons set out in the Scottish Government response, and that's the paragraph 39 reference.
Okay, thank you for that. But you said to me a moment ago that there had been an assessment made of the prospect's success, that there was an arguable case to defend, but then there was information that was not available at that point that subsequently came to light. But does that not suggest that whoever made that assessment of the defensibility of the case hadn't done their job properly?
You can only make an assessment on the prospects of the case on the information you have.
But that information did exist, it just hadn't been found. So whoever was making the decision to defend the case hadn't sufficiently done their homework.
Well, I certainly weren't aware of that information. As emerged in the course of the work around the specification and the commission diligence.
Okay, let me turn to the actual timeline and process of the judicial review, because there were various adjustments made by the Scottish Government to the open record. Now, there was an adjustment made on the 5th of November 2018. which then provided detailed factual information on the development of the procedure and the contact between the complainants, Ms A and Ms B,
yep.
and senior employees of the Scottish Government. So was that the point at which the Scottish Government realised that there was crucial evidence that had not been previously available to it that put its legal position in a much weaker situation than it previously had been?
Those adjustments were made in response to adjustments that the petitioner had made slightly earlier than that, in fact, but the timeline. And that had raised a question and a call on Scottish Government. This is in the timeline, and at page 9 of the timeline, it was 23rd of October that the question first arose, where the petitioners were asking that question. And it was in the period then, towards the end of October and into the beginning of November, and there was a procedural hearing on the 6th of November, and it was around that that we then started a process, first of all, through the formal legal process of making adjustments to respond to that, to make sure the Scottish position was accurately and correctly narrated to the court. But separately from that, that's when the question started to arise as to try to ascertain what this meant, what had happened and what was going on. And it was really from that process onwards and leading on to the specification, which was around the kind of middle of November, that the questions then were starting to be asked, actually in two respects, one of which is the kind of, you know, what's this issue? And then separately, because there'd been a specification by Leave McRae, it was given in draft on the 2nd of November, that was later taken forward. That led to a situation where we then started to undertake an exercise trying to find the documents. So there's two separate things, if you like. There was, what does this mean? Mm-hmm. And who do we need to ask to find out what this means? And that actually was a relatively small number of people, because this had all been kept, you know, was for understandable reasons, kept quite tight. So it wasn't a huge number of people. But what was done at that point was then trying to work out, you know, what's the significance of this? What actually happened? Because people were obviously, those who were involved at the time knew about it, but they were now being asked a year later. Mm-hmm. So there was a bit of time taken to try to work out what was this about and what's the significance of it. And then separately from that, there was the finding of the documents.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. And then there was a further adjustment made on the 20th of November, 2018, where answer 19 was adjusted by the Scottish Government to state, and I quote, that prior to her appointment as IO investigating officer, Ms McKinnon had involvement and contact with the complainers.
Indeed.
So that, again, that had come out of the Commission on Diligence, had it?
That had come out, no, the Commission of Diligence was a little bit later. Yeah. That had come out from the searches that were then done for documents which were provided to Leave McRae. I think that's page 13 of the timeline. On page 12 of the timeline, you can see a reference to three tranches of documents. The 16th and 21st of November, three tranches of documents were sent to Leave McRae. There was actually once on the 16th of November, a further bunch on the 19th of November. Then actually they were all collated into a third inventory of productions, they were sent in response to Leave McRae's call of the 12th of November. So it was the documents that were emerging from that point that were gathered together, and as the timeline recognised, there was 110 documents. And so it was the collation of that information as we had it then, plus the process of examining what all of this meant and what was an understanding of what had happened before that led then to those further adjustments.
Thank you. At what point between the 5th and the 20th of November did it become clear to you that this was a fundamental change in the Scottish Government's case?
I mean, it was clear from my first becoming aware of it that this was potentially a significant problem.
And when did you first become aware of it?
I first became aware of that towards the end of October 2018.
Right.
I'd first seen something in writing, I think the 31st of October, but that wasn't the first I knew of it. I knew a few days prior to that. It was the last few days in October.
And when you became aware of that, and presumably at that point, you must have realised this was very damaging to the government's case.
I realised that if the circumstances were as they were set out by the petitioner, then that was a potentially serious issue, right, and had to be really looked at. We had to find out and properly ascertain what the factual circumstances were, and then we'd take a view, obviously, once we'd done that, as to what and what that meant for our ability to defend.
Were your concerns at that point shared with the Permanent Secretary?
I'm pretty certain they were. I can't precisely say, but they certainly were. They were very much shared with we had a coordinating team who were taking responsibility, if you like, for the policy instruction, and that was within the Permanent Secretary's office, because it was her procedure. The officials who were our first port of call were in the Permanent Secretary's office. I mean, I would presume the Permanent Secretary would know, but I can't say for certain. But it certainly was through her office.
Right. Okay. And the Lord Advocate, he would have been aware of this.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Okay. So we came to a point end of October. It became clear that there was a significant flaw in the Scottish Government position of which you had not previously been aware. I suppose my question is, why then did it take until January before the Scottish Government made a decision to concede the case? Why did it take more than 2 months?
That led into the process of identifying the documents and trying to establish what the factual circumstances actually fully were. And the development of that through, as you can see from the timeline as it developed, it involved a number of stages in all of that. And actually, it's quite telling in some ways that the initial indication from Leaving McRae towards the end of October, there was a specification, then a further call on the 12th of November, they intimated a further request, then a subsequent specification, is that it took time to work out what this actually really meant. It wasn't really a kind of, in that sense, a slam dunk moment. There was work that required to be done, and we required to try to establish what the full factual circumstances were, and then work out whether, as indeed is set out in the grounds for the ultimate concession, whether the combination of the wording of paragraph 10 of the procedure, along with the facts as they were emerging and continued to emerge as we found out more and more, actually had that effect.
Okay, and one more question, Convener, if I may. We've already talked about the award of expenses at the highest level. Was the award of expenses, which I believe was agreed by the Scottish Government, did that reflect the fact that it had taken some time for the Scottish Government to reach the point of conceding the case?
Yeah, in a sense, yes, because having taken so long to have got that stage, the commission and diligence became essential.
Yeah.
And so they're all linked in. I mean, I think the fact that, as I said in the response to the question earlier, a commission diligence is a pretty rare beast.
And expensive.
And indeed expensive. And it was set down with a senior advocate, initially for 3 days, only actually ran for two, as it turns out, because of the circumstances. But yes, the need to go to that, certainly that in itself added to the expense.
Okay, thank you very much.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Mr. Caquet.
Yes, good morning.
In response to Margaret Mitchell, you indicated you would give us a breakdown of the 118,000 that was spent on external counsel, but you also very helpfully indicated that you could probably provide an estimate of the amount of money spent internally by the Scottish Government. And I would be very grateful if you would send that to the committee, because clearly this has involved a significant amount of time and effort within the government, and just having an appreciation of that would be very helpful. So can I take you up on that offer? Thank you. Can I just take you way back, just so that I'm clear about timelines? Were you responsible for any of the legal advice when the policy was devised in November 2017, December 2017?
No, I wasn't the legal director at that stage.
So who was responsible? I mean, I don't need a name. A title would do fine for actually providing the legal advice for the development of the policy.
Well, it would have been provided by my predecessor, effectively, or if you like, in the name of my predecessor, who would have done, as I've sought to explain my role, is not maybe dealt with the kind of individual minutiae of every particular individual aspect, but would have assigned the role to an appropriate official or group of officials within a division there.
Okay. Well, Judith McKinnon, in evidence to us last week, said she got advice throughout the process from an employment lawyer. I'm assuming that somebody within the civil service. Is it appropriate for us to know who that person is?
I'm afraid I would say no, because that would indicate source and content.
Well, but it
was an employee of the Scottish Government.
Okay. Well, let me ask you, were you aware subsequently of those discussions, the advice given at that stage? Because obviously you have a coordinating role.
Yeah.
I'm assuming that lawyer still worked for the Scottish Government and therefore would have information to provide.
I wasn't aware to the kind of minutiae level of every single bit of communication, but yes, I was aware that the advice had been given and who had given it, and the generality of what had been given.
Okay.
You know, looking backwards.
Did that cover the involvement of Judith McKinnon as the independent officer or the investigating officer?
Yeah, it involved all aspects of the advice, both in relation to the development of the policy, and questions based on the information available to the lawyer concerned on the question of appointment.
So when did you have that discussion? Given that you were, you know, newly into the role of coordinator, was that early on in the process, just to try and find out by way of background what had happened?
Not that discussion in that respect. I mean, as I say, I found it a little bit later on. I mean, obviously, I did have a bit of a discussion. I found out that the complaint had been made and was being investigated as a cause for concern. I think it had been held as a cause for concern by that stage on my third day in post. So the first I knew about, I know.
Lucky white head.
The first I knew was then. And in discussions on that day, I it was explained to me what the general background and what the context of what this was. Obviously not in kind of that level of minutiae of detail. But yeah, I mean, I knew enough at that point to know that there had been the procedure and that who'd been appointed and the like to help inform my understanding of going forward. What I should say, of course, is feeling like an 800-metre runner, starting halfway through when everyone else is sprinting and you're going for a standing start, there was quite a lot that was ongoing at that point, particularly as when I started, we were in the middle of correspondence with Leighton McRae with about the procedural concerns about the then ongoing investigation with the IO. There's quite a lot going on.
I appreciate your difficulty. What I'm trying to establish was, at any stage, did anybody tell you, as you were coming up to speed with this, that actually Judith McKinnon had prior involvement with any of the complainants?
No, I wasn't.
You didn't know that?
No.
Okay. Again, last week, Judith McKinnon suggested that the final version of the policy was somehow different to earlier iterations, specifically in relation to paragraph 10. I wonder whether I could read to you the very first draft of the policy, where it talked about, and I quote, nominate a member of the SCS who had no prior involvement in any aspect of the complaint. So would you agree that the point was actually clear from the start?
From the initial version?
Yes. I've just quoted to you the words in the very first version of the policy.
So you read it again, please.
Yeah. Okay. This is the first draft of the policy, and it said, nominate a member of the SCS who had no prior involvement in any aspect of the complaint. So my question is, would you agree that that point was actually very clear from the start?
Well,
there's no way of misinterpreting this.
No. You've heard evidence from James Hind, and indeed attached to the timeline, it's his indication of what that meant.
But I'm asking you, as the person who was coordinating the government's response to the judicial review, somebody who obviously thinks carefully about his words as a lawyer, that there was no difference between the first draft of the policy and the final one in terms of what the intent was. Surely we can agree.
I'm certainly struggling to see a difference. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you. That's all I'm trying to establish.
Yes.
So let me come back to did you know that Miss McKinnon had extensive prior involvement with complainants before she was appointed as the investigating officer?
That was, again, at the end of October 2018.
End of October. Okay. You'll forgive me if I go over some of the ground that my colleague went over. I just want to fix this in my mind. At the end of October, did you warn colleagues of the implications of this? What action did you take?
As I say, we had to investigate the kind of the context of what this meant. I think everybody who was involved realised that this was a potentially significant issue. I don't think no one needed to be told.
So what action did you take? Was there a discussion with council? Was there a discussion with Judith McKinnon? I'm kind of interested to unpick that.
At that stage, I didn't have direct discussion with Judith McKinnon, but what we did was, as I said in answering to Mr Fraser's question, I think it was Mr Fraser's question, about the how we coordinated the work through the Permanent Sex Office, then at that stage, that office then started a process of trying to work out what the correct factual narrative and circumstances were, who spoke to who and whatever, and then try to work out what it all meant. So,
but as you said earlier, I'm quoting you correctly, this was the perm sex procedure.
So
she would have conceivably known. She was party to some of the email traffic.
I mean, yes, it was certainly her procedure. It certainly was adopted under her auspices initially, yes.
Okay. Can I take you back to some of the meetings? Because there's a very interesting Freedom of Information request that was published on the 13th of September 2019. It lists 17 meetings with council. Okay. Can I just pinpoint when was council first involved? Was that at the 23rd of August? That's the first meeting listed?
No, council was involved around the time I was appointed. A junior was involved, I think, before, and I was involved in commissioning senior counsel to be involved in that. That first meeting would have been a meeting specifically in relation to the judicial review, which only it effectively occurred on the 23rd of August, because that was the date in which we were given intimation of a draft petition that was serving us the next week.
So council were involved before that, but this only on the 23rd of August in relation to the judicial review.
Exactly so.
Okay. They went on to be involved to the 7th of January. And let me ask you this. It was the same council throughout?
Yes.
Okay. That's very helpful to know. Would it be fair to say, and I'm not asking about the advice, I'm asking about the position on prospects of success. Did that change?
Well, yes, but it did ultimately change, yes.
Okay, but let me come back to something you said to Murdo Fraser, because your response to Murdo Fraser was it was proper to defend.
Yeah.
And you picked your words very carefully.
Yeah.
What I'm asking you is at that initial stage, what were the prospects for success? And I'm not asking for the content of the legal advice, because the question posed is different to your response.
Sure.
You're answering a different question,
with
all due respect.
Yeah, I mean the prospects. Kept content under our reviews as they went. It was only at that stage, at the end, leading up to the concession on the 2nd of January, that it became clear that it would be improper to defend.
Okay.
If I could put it like that.
So
there's different. You get different views as you go. Any litigation goes up and down a little bit, but and as information arises and as you develop your potential answers. But at the point of the concession, that was the point at which it would have been improper.
But you could have a position. Forgive me, I'm not a lawyer, so I'm just exploring this with you. You could have a position where you would consider it proper to defend, even though the prospects of success weren't good.
Yes, that can always happen.
Okay.
And there can be circumstances in which you get different sources of advice from different people. Council's advice is not the Scottish Government's position that informs the Scottish sure. Government's position, et cetera.
So council could have said to you, your prospects of success aren't really good here, and the Scottish Government could decide itself, well, we're going ahead nevertheless, it is proper to defend.
It could
that
do that.
That would be consistent with what you've told
yes,
us.
Yes, and that's right. If council had said it's improper to defend, then that's very different. And we did not defend beyond the stage in which
absolutely.
It was improper.
You got to a point where you know the game was up, I think, would be the description. Okay, can I just ask you again, to aid my understanding, lots of people are listed as exempt in this FOI from being named as being at the meeting. Mm. Would that typically include the lawyers for the Scottish Government, the Lord Advocate, senior counsel, junior counsel? Is that a fair interpretation of the people that are likely to have been there?
There's two sets of people who were noted as exempt, one of which is the lawyers involved, and the other are non-senior civil servants.
Okay, good. Okay. Can I take you to the meeting on the 19th of October then? That was the one attended by Judith McKinnon, Dr. Nicola Richards, James Hind. In evidence last week, Judith McKinnon said she spoke to external counsel. Was that at that meeting?
That was one meeting I wasn't at.
I
was in leave that week.
Okay, lucky you. But I'm sure as the coordinator, you would know all about it.
In reference to one of my answers afterwards, it was in the period after I returned from leave was the point at which I was told.
You became aware.
I became aware.
But was it the case that at the meeting on the 19th of October, council became aware of Judith McKinnon's involvement?
Well, I don't know if I could factually answer that question. I mean, I suspect that the council would have known that Judith McKinnon was the investigating officer.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure I could say more about that.
Could you find out? I mean, if it's
I'm
wondering, so for example, from that meeting, did somebody prepare a report for council on the extent of the involvement? Was that when the red flag went up?
Yeah. I can certainly ask for to see if we can provide a fuller answer to that, subject to any LPP issues around that.
Okay. Because I'm just conscious that we have a meeting with Judith McKinnon and external counsel on the 19th of October, and then a meeting with a cast of thousands that can't be named on the 23rd of October, and Judith McKinnon wasn't there, nor was she there at any of the other meetings thereafter. Mm. So it seems to have been established on the 19th of October there was a problem.
Well, I can't see what happened on the 19th of October, but certainly it was in the period after that that there clearly became an issue arising.
Okay.
So
it would be safe for me to infer, given that you weren't there, you were on holiday, that actually on the 19th of October is when the government became aware. A report may or may not have been made to council, and on the 23rd of October, a cast of thousands meets, because something I'm inferring from this seems to be wrong.
Yeah.
Would that be fair?
I think you can draw your own inference, but I don't think I can comment more than that.
Okay, well, if you can provide any further light on this, I'm sure the committee would be most grateful. So at what point did external counsel say to you, there's a difficulty here?
That, again, I can't answer that. That involves source and content of advice.
Oh, okay, sorry. I just thought because it was a process issue, I would be able to ask that question.
I don't think so. But okay. Again, I can take...
Well, you're the lawyer here.
Take it
I'm not.
I'm also a witness to this. I'm not the current director of legal services.
Okay. But you never leave it behind.
No, you never can.
Let me just ask you. You came back from holiday. You were aware at the end of October, but council could have been saying, between the 19th of October and the end of October, we have a problem. They could have been.
It could have been, yeah.
They could have been. Thank you. That helps my understanding. Can I ask, there's a meeting listed here, 13th of November. It lists the First Minister, Elizabeth Lloyd, the Permanent Secretary, and Council, one would assume. Maybe. Why was there no SGLD official there? Do you know?
No, I don't know.
Okay, you don't know what the meeting was about? Even though you're responsible for coordinating everything?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. In addition to the 17 meetings with council, okay, we heard that there were catch-up meetings three times a week. Were your staff involved in that?
There were series of meetings. I think the reference to three times a week, I think, was from last week's evidence with Barbara Allison.
That was the first we've heard about it.
Absolutely. I was involved in daily meetings with the PermSex coordinating team, which may or may not have been the same set of three times a week meetings, but the meetings I was involved with were meetings with a sort of regular catch-up on the kind of handling of where we were and planning the kind of next steps, and that involved officers from the PermSex department and almost invariably COBS people involved in that as well. I don't think I would say that people like special advisors were involved in all of these meetings or even to the frequency of three times a week. It was certainly there were occasions when SPADs would have been at these meetings, especially at points when there was a kind of an external statement of the Scottish Government position, say a procedural hearing, for example, and so the Commons handling of that was something that special advisors would have a close and legitimate interest in.
Sure.
So there were meetings that took place on a regular basis, which I would usually attend with members of my staff.
So let me just be clear about this. You talked about daily meetings. When did they start? When did they end?
The daily meetings were more or less all of the time.
Okay.
From when I took up post.
Fine.
And I think probably through to the end of the GR, actually.
So sometimes the PermSec would be there, but it would certainly be all her staff.
Her staff.
Her staff.
I don't think she was ever at any of them. It was her.
Okay. But she would be aware of what's going on, because if her private secretary is there, you know, she would definitely.
Yeah.
Okay. That's fine. Can I therefore ask, at these daily meetings, did you discuss with them specifically the problem that you were alerted to at the end of October with Judith McKinnon?
The detail I can't talk about, but yes.
We
knew that there was things that had to be looked at, and that involved in particular issues that were obviously unfamiliar to lay people around what specification of documents is and what commission diligence is.
Sure. But you were aware the end of October that there was a problem here. Okay.
There was an issue to be addressed, yes, absolutely.
And in that respect, did you provide advice to the Permanent Secretary, given that it was your role to do so?
I provided advice to the team I was working with on that. There was ongoing advice regularly given
period. And at that stage, did your advice touch on the prospects of continued success of the case?
The advice at that stage would have been informed by such factors if we were reaching the stage that the prospects were now moving to a position where it was becoming an unsatable case. So
sorry, I'm a very simple soul. Does that mean you thought you were on a hiding to nothing and you told the PermSec that in fancier language?
It's the other way around.
Is it the other way around?
Unless and until we got to that stage where we felt that the case was unsustainable, that there was no reason every day to say, by the way, the case is still okay, if you see what I mean.
I don't really.
No.
No.
So I didn't go home every night thinking, you know, is the case still okay? Yes, it is, I'm fine, or give advice to that effect. That's not how advice works, if you see what I mean.
So I'm curious then, if you think that there was a fatal moment, as we would see it, where the role of the investigating officer clearly was tainted by bias, I think is the language that was used, because she had a substantive role in advance of appointment, recognising that that was a real problem...
Yeah.
You didn't advise the Permanent Secretary that actually we are in some difficulty? I'm curious to know why the Scottish Government chose to keep going for another 2 months, okay?
Yeah.
At cost to the taxpayer, and not concede the case when you as a lawyer would have known that the game was up?
Well,
you're
no,
a good lawyer.
Yeah, I don't know if it's right to say that I would have known at that point, because we still had to ascertain what the facts were.
Okay. How long did it take you to ascertain what the facts were?
Well, the work then proceeded in relation to the specification of documents, and more documents emerged in the course of the specification and then ultimately in the course of the commission of diligence.
Did you go back to the lawyer that advised Judith McKinnon along the way and ask for more information?
The lawyers, including those who were involved at the time, continue to be involved at all stages in that.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So this individual was still involved in the judicial review process and didn't kind of alert you to this information, didn't provide the clarification required, nothing, silence.
He alerted me to the information that he was aware of.
He wasn't aware of this?
Well, no, I'm not saying he wasn't aware of the generality of this. What I'm saying is the detail of what emerged only became really clear.
Okay.
As we moved into the commission diligence.
Okay. Can I ask you, did you at any time tell anybody, Judith McKinnon, anybody else, that it would be possible to assist the judicial review if the police investigation could be moved forward?
Put in that sense, no. We could think of assisting cases, but
Was never suggested.
I'm just trying to understand that the question infers that if we could somehow persuade the police to do that, could we assist? And that's what I take issue with. There was no suggestion on my part that we tried to influence the process. If, on the other hand, it had been the case that a police investigation were investigated, were initiated, I think I would have been firmly of the view that it ought to have been assisted in order to let the criminal process, due process, and a criminal in that sense is more important than civil for various reasons that are fairly obvious.
Sure. So did you ever discuss assisting the case?
Assisting would always be an option in relation to these cases.
I'm just asking, did you discuss it?
Again, I need to be careful about the kind of the content of this, but I wouldn't dispute the fact that the idea of assisting would have been a perfectly appropriate thing to have done if the circumstances had required it. And the most obvious one would have been, looking back, had the charges been preferred, say, in the autumn, when we were still working through the case. If I could answer this in the abstract to avoid me getting into specific legal advice, I think then I'd have said definitely. I suggested it from our perspective. I would have said that would be something you would want to do.
Can I just push you on one final question, because I don't want to take the convener's patience in vain. So I'm still not clear why it took you, not you personally, the Scottish Government, till January to concede the case. Why did it take so long, knowing what you knew?
What we knew emerged and developed in our assessment, of the circumstances emerged as we go. Obviously, this case, as much as any, was obviously extremely important, extremely high profile. But all cases, all litigation, in my experience, is something of a roller coaster where your prospects go up and down. And this, I don't dispute this was significant. I'm not trying to diminish that aspect for a moment. But we were due to be going into a four-day judicial review on the 15th of January. We went through a process, again, perhaps reference the timeline is maybe relevant here, in looking at the ways in which we were considering our responses and how our adjustments to our position could put in a fair position before the court what our views were, and it was in the kind of only in the development of that and the thinking of what our response would be that we reached a view, because a number of things come into play. One of which is the factual circumstances, the other is the analysis of the documents that were emerged, and the third is the question of the legal prospects as you go. And one of the things you would think about, again, trying to put this on an abstract level, is even standing this difficulty that clearly had become to our attention. Did it follow that that meant the case absolutely had to be conceded, or were there things that we could say, if you see what I mean? So the time was taken, and time would be taken then to analyse the any legal precedents, and what procedural fairness means, what apparent bias means, and how that and that takes time to work through.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you. Mr. Kiquette, thank you very much for giving us so much time, and I hope you'll bear with me a little bit longer. We've heard a lot of information from you, and thank you for that. There's a couple of things I would just like to clarify in my own mind. Please excuse me if you've gone over it already. There's been a lot to take in. The first thing, just to get clear with me, is you reported to the Director General for Constitutional Affairs.
Yes.
Just refresh my memory, who was that?
It was Ken Thompson.
Ken Thompson, yeah. Thank you very much. And did you deal a lot with Ken Thompson at the time over this particular issue? Or was it, as you said earlier, very much the Permanent Secretary's procedure?
It was very much Permanent Secretary's procedure. I didn't deal in any way with Ken Thompson up until the point at which the JR started, because of the way we were structuring things to keep the confidentiality of this as narrow as it could. And so my dealings were effectively through the Permanent Secretary's office at that point. Once the JR started, I said a bit more to him, because I was more at liberty to do so. But to all intents and purposes, it was proceeded through the Permanent Secretary's office rather than my own Director General.
Yeah, so you worked... I think, Alison, do you have a supplementary to that?
Particular point.
All right, yes. We'll try Mr. Kiquette's patience for even longer then. thank you. Can I also ask, you talked about the missing information.
Yeah.
I mean, there's been quite a lot of discussion about that and when it came to light. Which department was actually tasked with supplying that information for the judicial review?
So is that in relation to the emerging difficulty?
Everything. You know, right. You've got a judicial review. Yeah. Information is obviously required. So
yeah.
Who was responsible for that?
In that sense, again, the coordination was through the Permanent Secretary's office. Because of the high-profile nature of this and the sensitivity of the information, the number of holders of documents and people who'd be looking for information on that was actually relatively small. In other circumstances, and perhaps more typical litigation, there might be a much broader involvement of people. But actually, it was very much that kind of narrow group through the Permanent Secretary's office, through the likes of James Hind, who you've had evidence from, and from people who we thought were involved in the development of the policy and its application, such as Judith McKinnon and Nicky Richards, who you've taken evidence from. So it was a pretty small, compact group of people.
Mm-hmm. And was it the same group of people who were tasked with going back to see if they'd missed anything?
Yeah, I mean, in effect, I mean, that was a number of things were happening in tandem with each other. Uh-huh. And it was the same group who had the knowledge and understanding of what happened at the time to try to make sense of it, were also the same people who, in that very tight group, were the holders of the documents concerned. And one of the difficulties arose in trying to identify the documents, although this was kind of later in the process, by the time we were heading towards the commission diligence, was that some of those officials were then had gone off on a lengthy Christmas leave. One of them particularly had left on the 14th December. Remember the days when you used to be able to go to the Far East for your holidays for long holidays over Christmas, and that actually did give rise. that did give rise to actually some practical issues, especially at that point. In searching for documents, because they were in people's email accounts and H drives that they had access to and they knew the passwords to, And it was quite difficult at that stage. I'm not saying earlier, in the sort of November period, but in at that stage, as we moved towards the commission of diligence, there was a real practical issue that arose of actually getting hold of documents. And so, for example, although we ultimately required to find a way around this, it wasn't really possible to ask other people to search their inboxes, like IT people, just because of the sensitivity of the information you're looking for. So actually, there were a number of practical problems. I think if I had more time, I could maybe try
you
to...
You can have as much time as you like.
Well, I'd be delighted to give more... I'd be very happy to give more colour to the challenges that were faced in dealing with the specification right from the beginning and throughout. One of them was an issue about people who weren't there. Others were issues about the extent to which we were able and had properly identified things like search criteria as to what to look for, and people were it was a relatively small number of people, and that was an advantage and a disadvantage. The advantage of it was being a small number of people, therefore we were able to ask for that information without asking the entire government to be searching, because that would be completely inappropriate to do. So we couldn't treat it like an FOI request, which actually the commission in some ways, especially the occasion of document the commission, in some ways is quite similar to an FOI request, except that you don't apply exemptions effectively, rather the commissioner applies exemptions. So it was a smaller number of people who were asked to do these things, but at the same time they were also, by virtue of being that small number of people, they had a task that was enormous to do, as it transpired, looking at the amount of information that was there. And again, the question is of how we were able to access and check email accounts and no doubt password protected H drive documents and various things, and people were out the country.
I'm glad you're happy to be generous with your time, because I'm having all these other requests coming in. if I could ask members to be fairly brief with their questions. Alison Johnson, then Angela Constance.
Thank you, convener. Is it your view that the Scottish Government considered that it had a robust procedure in place for dealing with the harassment complaint?
Yes, I mean, the legal view, the collective legal view was yes.
And would you agree then that to be considered robust, a procedure would actually have to be very carefully adhered to?
Well, yes.
Yes. So obviously, the much-quoted paragraph 10, which says that the investigating officer will have had no prior involvement with any aspect of the matter being raised.
Yeah.
It just seems to me that that paragraph was always sitting there. So is it your view that the government's case was ever okay then? That it was ever strong, given that paragraph in the procedure is sitting there and it hadn't been adhered to?
Yeah. I mean, I'd refer generally, as I say, to paragraph 39 of the government's statement produced in September. And the reason I reference that is because the legal position is assessed in the context of the reading of that paragraph with the facts and the circumstances applied, and that's where the concern arose that was the ground of concession eventually. Paragraph 10 in itself, looked at in isolation, there's in a sense nothing wrong with that. It's as you'd be saying, it's how it's applied in the circumstance. Now, James Hind has given evidence before, and he's produced a document that explains what it was endeavouring to cover. But if you look at it even now in its terms, I don't think there's anything wrong with that, as long as the facts, as applied to the right facts. So if a different investigating officer had been appointed, for example...
No, absolutely. If an investigating officer had been appointed who had had absolutely no prior involvement with any aspect of this case, then I'm sure...
It would have been very different. So it's the combination. All my point is the combination, I think, is the point I'd make.
Yeah, absolutely. So, just for clarity, you've suggested earlier that the government's position didn't deviate from the legal advice, or didn't deviate substantially from the legal advice. So the legal advice wasn't fully informed.
It, it, in the development of the policy, it was fully informed at the time that the facts as emerged towards the end of 2018, as read, but the policy led us to that conclusion that it was the risk of an appearance of bias occurred.
Okay. So, in your view, was it legal advice given on the basis of insufficient information or only part of the information that was required to fully formulate a proper view?
Yeah. The final view was reached on the basis of the information we then had. As has been said in the statement before, it was based on a view of the information which had by then become available. I can only refer to the timeline from last week. So it is the information that had by then become available.
So is it your view that very pertinent and relevant documents simply were not made available at the time they should have been?
Again, no. My view is consistent with what's said in the statement there.
Okay. No further questions, Convener. Thank you.
Angela Constance and then Maureen Watt.
Thank you very much, Convener. Sorry to prolong the carry-on lawyers routine, but could I ask, can you tell us, Mr. Kikett, how many lawyers have been involved in this saga, both internally and in terms of junior and senior counsel?
there's a question. How many in total?
More than 10? Less than 10?
Probably around.
Pick a number.
Probably around 10. I'd like to think about the precise number at various points. It's probably at various. The whole process is probably the different aspects of things, probably around 10 or 12, I'd have thought, from the legal directorate, looking at different aspects of things.
Okay, so that's a fair number of folk from the learned profession. Did anybody ask or even think about asking Miss McKinnon if she had any prior involvement with the complainants before taking on the investigating officer's role?
I don't know what was asked around the time that she was involved in the taking on of that role. From my perspective, I didn't ask that question from when I came into post because I didn't know of that issue and I didn't really have any reason to ask for that. I think that's probably true for a number of people.
So none of the lawyers involved in this situation thought it was something that should have been asked of Miss McKinnon in terms of her history with the complainants. Nobody thought about asking that. And, I'm struggling to understand why you, as the head lawyer, if you like, weren't aware or appraised of, what the entire legal team were asking, thinking, past and present. I appreciate you were, landed with this position, but...
I'm not sure what the question is. Sorry. why wasn't I?
Why were you not aware of what your colleagues were pursuing or asking? I mean, presumably, I'm not a lawyer, but it would seem like a basic need for all the information to be on the table for all the lawyers.
Sure.
And yet you can't tell me whether any lawyer thought it was, whether indeed they asked Miss McKinnon about her prior involvement.
Yeah. And it clearly was the case that the absolute significance of this only emerged in the course of the judicial review, so it may well be that's why it wasn't thought to be something that would have been explored and investigated at that time. I mean, it's something that had the kind of it was if you like at the kind of roots of the start of the process.
Yeah, I'm just curious as to why no lawyer thought it prudent to ask some in-depth questions to the investigating officer about process that included prior involvement. But It's all going to remain a bit of a mystery, apparently, convener. Can I just finally ask if Mr. Cacquet could just summarise in plain English why the government decided to concede the case?
I missed the very last. I got to the plain English point, didn't hear the last bit.
Can you explain in plain English why the government decided to concede the case?
I think that the most I can do is repeat. I can read it out again, but reference to paragraph 39 of the statement. That it was a review of the case informed by legal advice. The combination of those two factors, as I said to Alison Johnson, impacted on the case. That is the meaning of paragraph 10. Although it was clear to those involved in the development of this operation, it was obviously open to a different interpretation and to what prior contact meant. And then, having regard to the totality of the investigating officer's dealings with the complainants before her appointment, the reasonable observer could conclude there was a real possibility she could not act impartially, as she was required to do by the procedure.
Was that plain enough English for you, Ms. Constance?
I still don't know why nobody asked Mr. McKinnon the obvious question, but we'll leave it at that.
Okay. Maureen Watt, then Alex Cole-Hamilton, quickly, and then we'll wind up.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Mr. Cacquet. Clearly, all this work was going on in the Scottish Government Legal Department with advice coming from council and all that kind of stuff. How often were briefing papers on this sent to ministers, and which ministers? And were you involved in writing any of them?
Yeah. Briefing papers, anything that would be given by way of briefing to ministers, because of the nature of this case, would have had legal content and legal involvement in it. I'm trying to think of the frequency of this. I know that there was a paper, which I think actually Sarah Davidson, who's due to come on after me, was principal drafter of, at the end process when we gave advice in a collective way in relation to the conceding of the case. The speed of which matters progressed was such that we didn't give kind of regular updates in that sense. I mean, I'm not saying ministers didn't know. There was regular discussions and regular information given to them. But it wasn't done in a kind of like a weekly briefing or this is what's happened here or whatever. If there were significant changes of circumstances, then advice would have been given. As I say, the crucial and important one to that was the report that's prepared to the end. But ministers were involved and informed at all stages. But the speed at which matters went is it wasn't really set out in the sense of kind of significant briefing or in that sort of or kind of methodical briefing, if you like, in that kind of way.
But ministers are normally informed by written briefings.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So you're saying that ministers were not given a formal briefing on this till the end of the process? Written briefing on this till the end of the process?
They got written briefing. What I'm saying is they weren't given sort of a kind of a commentary as we went as to, you know, what the prospects are as of now. And the current situation, they were given briefings, and that included written briefings of the development of the case. And as matters emerged, they were fully informed.
But not written, regular written. Well,
not written in the sense
not
of kind
something
of
something that they could give feedback on.
That I could give feedback, or the minister could give feedback on.
Ministers could give feedback on.
Well, I suspect they could give feedback on it, but not the briefings weren't really prepared in the sense that those around the room who've been ministers will expect the normal briefing to have been given. But it's not to say they weren't told about significant issues as they arose.
So are you saying that it was just in kind of informal chat?
No. What I'm saying is that there were discussions, but there was also written advice given, but not in the kind of ministerial submission sense of the word, to any great extent.
So there were no regular ministerial submissions until the very end of the process.
Yeah. It was such a fast-moving set of circumstances that there didn't really need to be in that sense.
Okay, so the recommendation or the decision to reject arbitration, was that written or was that just a kind of informal chat? Or?
Well, no, that was written, but that was in June, July. And so at that point, whatever the WhatsApps might have been separately, the procedure was such that the First Minister and other ministers were not aware through the procedure. However, it might be suggested they were otherwise aware. There was no advice given to ministers in relation to the those aspects of the conduct of the procedure because it was the perm-sex procedure.
Okay, I think we've heard that before. Thank you.
Okay, you'll be pleased to know, Mr. Cricket, that I'm putting my foot down. So it's a very quick question from Mr. Cole Hamilton, followed by an extremely quick question from Miss Bailey.
They will be quick.
Alex Cole
Hamilton. Thank you, Convener, and thank you for bringing me back in. They will be very quick. Small supplementaries. Firstly, it's just two linked areas. I did say it when I finished my first round that I had two more. Firstly, relating to your answers to Jackie Bailey, very helpfully, I think, set out for us that legal advice is never binary. It's not you're going to win or you're going to lose. Yeah. It's a balance of probabilities. It's the yes, you've got an arguable case, but here are the chances of success. And it's fluid, and that those chances of success will diminish as this happens from time to time.
Yes.
And there's a tipping point. There's a point at which legal counsel will tell the client, and not to just talking about this, but generally, listen, the chances of success are so small now, it's not worth going on.
Yeah.
And I'm sure every client in history wants to believe they can still win.
Yeah.
And they will cling on to that hope. And they may do so to the point where their counsel threatens to resign because they're not being listened to. Does that happen generally, would you imagine?
I wouldn't have said it would happen generally. Yeah.
Did it happen in this case?
The scenario, I can't comment on what this case, okay. But the scenario that prospects change over time is a common feature of litigation.
But you can see a scenario where I'm getting at where
absolutely.
The Permanent Secretary, other government officials were so keen to press on with the glimmer of hope that legal counsel might have threatened to resign had they not heeded that advice about the diminished chances of success? It's a rhetorical question. Final question, on paragraph 10, Convener, if I may, paragraph 10 is still active, we've been told that, there's no amending guidance behind it.
Yeah.
Do you feel, A, that exposes the government to further legal risk, and B, that it might prevent other people coming forward to raise complaints about former ministers under this procedure?
It's still extant and it's unchanged just now. I actually, as I answer or try to answer to Alison Johnson, I don't think the wording in itself is necessarily wrong in all circumstances. If anybody were to come forward now, obviously we've learned in the practical operation that we wouldn't allow the situation to arise as arose in this particular case. And so although the wording might not have changed, again, referencing the fact it was a combination of the wording plus the facts led to the difficulty in this particular case, then I don't think the policy is necessarily inoperable. Your second question was a slightly different one, and I can see the point you're making, that it could be a situation where people are discouraged from coming forward because of the past experience that would arise. I don't think a change of the wording would in itself solve that, but it's obviously a very legitimate point. In trying to encourage people to have the confidence to come forward, it's important that there's a procedure that people have confidence and trust, and that's what's been reviewed by the government.
Because the judicial review collapsed 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And in those 2 years, not one single thing has changed about that policy. If you're in a position where you've been thinking about what happened to you in a historic context by a former minister, why on earth would you put yourself through that, given that nothing's been done to remedy that flawed procedure?
Yeah.
It's a rhetorical question.
It's a flawed question, but it flags up just how difficult it is for people who have these concerns and have been the subject of harassment in the past to have the confidence to come forward and have those properly concerned, they're properly investigated, and that's seen, you know, across the world. And that sense, it's obviously right to flag up that anything that discourages people to have the confidence that they will come forward and be believed and be investigated properly is something that none of us want that situation to be in place, and we all want a situation where people, men and women who could have been in that situation, could have the confidence to come forward and have their complaints investigated properly and thoroughly.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. We'll see if Jackie Bailey understands the concept of quick.
Very quick, and my apologies for having missed this. Were external counsel asked for an opinion on paragraph 10 and what it meant for the prospects of success, and when was that opinion sought?
Throughout the process, but specifically when the issue arose, then the focus became on paragraph 10. So they weren't asked for an opinion prior, because okay. None of us knew that was going to be an issue.
Could you tie down a date? I don't want to annoy the convener, but I'm looking for a date.
I think probably the best thing to do. I think we can give. I think we can give an indication of when that issue came into focus. It's whether I'm not sure about as to whether we asked them or they said to us or whatever. I'd need to go to look at the and ask colleagues to look at the background.
So
of
it
that.
Could have been that they said to you rather than you alerting them. It could have been on the 19th of October.
But again, it could have been. Okay. I wasn't at that meeting.
I look forward to hearing from you.
Okay, finally for me, Mr. Cricket, back to what seems like a long time ago now, in your first questioning, we talked about arbitration, and Alec Hamilton was very clear about showing the differences between arbitration and mediation.
Yes.
You talked around the decision not to go to arbitration.
Yes.
Some element of that being the potential effect it would have on the complainants.
Yes.
I would like you to summarise that, but also, could you refer to mediation? Is that a decision that you were involved in?
I wasn't involved in the decision of the mediation. I mean, my understanding was that the suggestion of mediation was put to the complainers, and they rejected that. My understanding was that the arbitration wasn't, not to my knowledge, arbitration wasn't put to them. And I can only presume that was because, having rejected mediation, there was obviously a sensitive relationship of constantly going back to the complainers and saying, well, you know, have you thought about X? And if you don't like X, you thought about Y. So they didn't do that. I mean, I think the key thing, I think, in terms of mediation and arbitration and the court system, is that there are I maintain my answer about the inappropriateness of arbitration to claims of harassment or sexual harassment, but it's also true, and in one sense truer, of mediation. Because if this was a means by which the matter could be resolved in a way that could have avoided court proceedings and could have been agreed by the parties, mediation doesn't really do that. And what I mean by that is, it's like there's a sort of matrix of decision making and dispute resolution. So the courts are mandatory. You can't avoid going to court if you're taken to court, and the outcome is binding. Arbitration is voluntary, but the outcome is binding. Mediation is voluntary, but the outcome is non-binding. So to go down the mediation track would have led to a risk that either party, if they didn't like the way the mediation was going, could have said, I'm not doing this anymore. And so as a means of getting to quick resolution, had I been involved in suggestions of mediation, which I wasn't because it was before my time, had I been involved, I would have suggested not, because of the non-binding nature of it. So I think so that's on the mediation aspect of things, it seemed to me, or it would seem to me, had I been involved at the time. But in any event, the complainers rejected that possibility.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Cricket. It's been an interesting session. And thank you for the discussion that we've had amongst us all. I think you've agreed to follow up certain things in writing, and we can liaise on that. So thank you again, and we'll now have a short break of a few minutes before we move on to the next.
Okay, thank you.
Can I now welcome Sarah Davidson a bit later than we asked Ms Davidson to come along, and I'm sorry to have kept you waiting like that. Sarah Davidson is the former Director General of Organisational Development and Operations in the Scottish Government. And I would begin by inviting Ms Davidson to take the affirmation. Ms Davidson, would you please raise your right hand and repeat after me? I solemnly, sincerely and truly declare and affirm.
I solemnly, sincerely and truly declare and affirm.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Thank you. May I invite Ms Davidson now, please, to make a brief opening statement.
Convener, thank you for the opportunity to make this short statement. The key points that I wanted to convey to the committee are set out in my written statement, but I thought it would be useful for context to briefly summarise my roles and responsibilities within the Scottish Government. I began working for the Scottish Government in 1995 and was deployed in a variety of roles and business areas. Latterly, after a period of maternity leave in 2012 to 2013, I returned as interim HR director for around 5 months at the start of 2014. I then took up the role of Director General for Communities, then moved to be DG Organisational Development and Operations when that role was created in July 2017. As DG ODO, I was a member of the Permanent Secretary's executive team and held a number of corporate responsibilities, as well as providing leadership and line management to the directorates of Communications, Ministerial Support and Facilities, Digital, Financial Management, Procurement and Commercial, People and Social Security. As the Permanent Secretary set out in her own evidence to the committee, staff in the majority of these directorates hold corporate professional roles and work across all of government. My line management role therefore focused primarily on supporting wellbeing, development and leadership, as well as fulfilling formal financial and management accountabilities. I left the Scottish Government in June 2019 to take up my current role. I have not retained any documents or information from my time with the Scottish Government, and nor have I had access to their systems since June 2019, including for the purposes of giving evidence today. In the time frame available to me, I have looked at a few key documents provided by the Scottish Government which have been published by the committee, but I've not reviewed all of the material that has been published. Accordingly, I will be answering the committee's questions without the benefit of having such information to review, but I will, of course, do so to the very best of my ability, bearing in mind these limitations. As a former civil servant, I'm obviously subject to some continuing obligations under the Civil Service Management Code, and so there may be, from time to time, certain constraints which I have to respect. Finally, I am aware that the Scottish Government has asserted legal privilege over certain documents and information to which I may refer, and I must respect that position. I've noticed that other witnesses have declared membership of the FDA where applicable, and I'll therefore take this opportunity to note that I am an FDA associate member. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Davidson. We'll move direct to questions from the committee. Can I have Margaret Mitchell, please, Deputy Convener?
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Ms Davidson. In your written evidence, you clearly state that you were not involved with the development of the 2017 procedure. If that's the case, can you confirm that you did not initiate any correspondence, text, emails, and that you were not copied into any emails, etc., correspondence concerning this?
Not to the best of my recollection.
Okay, thank you. You were line manager to Nicola Richards, Director of People, and you had oversight of her team, including Junith McKinnon, Head of People Advice. Did either or both make you aware of any concerns in relation to the judicial review during the period 16th of October to the 8th of December? That was the Scottish Government's legal position being established about then, and the first set of answers given on the 15th of October. If so, who raised them and what were these concerns?
So I recall becoming aware at some point, probably within the broad timescale that you're referring to, that questions had been raised in the judicial review procedure about the role of the investigating officer. I didn't know the detail of them. I wasn't close to the handling of the judicial review. And my understanding was that these were being managed in the context of proceedings, and that proceedings were continuing as had previously been planned. So I can't recall. I think it's likely it would have been Nicola Richards who brought that to my attention, but I can't recall precisely when.
Did she express concern?
I think it would be fair to say she expressed concern. She certainly knew that concerns had been raised and that further information was being sought from Judith McKinnon about those issues, and that these were being subject to discussion with lawyers, and I wasn't privy to those discussions with lawyers at any point.
And she expressed concern. Could you just elaborate on the nature specifically of the concern?
I don't think I can say any further in relation to that. There was an issue which had been raised. They were looking for further information, and it was clearly an issue which was of some concern to the lawyers.
And you aren't able to say if it was about her involvement with the complainers and up to during the procedure and then the fact that she was an investigating officer?
I can't recall the precise detail. It was about the role of the investigating officer, but which particular part it was, I can't recall.
Okay, thank you. In our evidence committee last week, Judith McKinnon stated that on the 31st of December 2018, she contacted the relevant director, saying she'd found further documents, including texts with Miss B, but was told to pause on sending anything through. Can you confirm if you were the director she was referring to?
So Judith McKinnon was dealing directly with SGLD on the provision of documents at all points. So no, and I don't think she would have referred to me as a director. I was the director general.
So she didn't tell you she had uncovered all these documents at that time?
Not that I recall, no. She was dealing with the litigation team at SGLD in relation to the provision of documents.
And were you aware that she was told to pause with that information?
So I was aware at that point, clearly, that the prospects of the case were under review. So it would, and that therefore the further commission to an extent must have been in doubt whether or not that commission would go ahead. So it wouldn't surprise me if she had been told to pause, but I can't recall now whether I knew that at the time.
Okay. You stated you had no involvement with the judicial review until mid-December 2018 when you were asked by the Permanent Secretary to compile a report for her to help inform next steps. How did you undertake that test? For example, where did you source the relevant information and from whom?
So the vast majority of it, start again. My recollection, as I think I say in my written evidence, was that there were three main parts to that advice, that it covered financial advice, which I was given by the principal finance officer, legal advice, which came from a variety of sources, but was collated and passed to me by the Director of Legal Services, and handling advice, which by my recollection was in some part reflecting advice about legal handling, which again would have come from SGLD, and in some part communications handling, which would have come from the Communications Directorate.
Okay. Specifically in regards to further documents identified by Ms. McKinnon in late December 2018, in compiling your report and taking cognizance of that, was there anything included in that that informed the later decision of the Scottish Government to concede?
So, thinking of the timeline that the Scottish Government produced for this, for the committee, by the time that I was pulling together and collating that advice, the further productions which Ms. McKinnon had passed into the process were known, and those informed the legal advice that I was given. So, yes, that legal advice reflected the lawyer's view at that point of the additional information that Ms. McKinnon had found. My recollection is I was pulling together that advice between something like the 23rd and 28th of December. And again, I think the timeline suggests that the further productions that had been made by Ms. McKinnon predated that.
Okay. And can I ask finally, are you aware of any kind of time frame for police involvement, either directly being asked to look at something or in a more generic manner to talk about harassment cases generally?
You mean within the organisation?
Yeah. No.
So I was aware at a number of points that the police were approaching people in the organisation, as you know, clearly as it was their right to do so, as part of an investigation. I cannot recall now how that mapped against the timeline of the judicial review here.
So police involvement at all, could you state just how or when you were involved or aware that there was some police involvement at any kind of level?
I think I would be misleading the committee if I attempted to put a date on that. I was aware that at certain points, I'm guessing during the period between August and the following, well, it was right through the following year, there were times when the police were having conversations with members of Scottish Government staff, but I have no recollection of specific times at all, and I wasn't personally involved in that at all, so I think that's partly why the dates wouldn't have stuck in my mind at all.
So it would be August 2018, right through the following year, was it?
August 2018, yes.
Okay, thank you, that's helpful.
Okay, we move now to Angela Constance, followed by Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Ms Davidson. Am I correct in saying that you were not involved in the development of the policy, but the Permanent Secretary was?
That's correct. Okay.
And you line-managed Nicola Richards directly. Therefore, you line-managed Judith McKinnon indirectly. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the investigation, you were not involved. Have I understood your...
That's correct.
Your written. Is that not quite unusual? Because you were a very senior civil servant. So,
in a way, there was nothing usual in some ways about this particular investigation. It would be unusual in normal terms for the Director General to get involved in the investigation of an HR complaint. That would normally be handled within the HR Directorate, with senior HR oversight from either Judith McKinnon or Nicola Richards. Because this complaint was being investigated under the Permanent Secretary's procedure, the decision was taken, I assume, by the Permanent Secretary, although it wasn't something that I ever discussed with her, that she would take the lead in being the person to whom the investigating officer reported. And given the need for, both, I think, to avoid unnecessary double handling, but also given the desire to maintain very strict confidentiality in relation to the complaints, there was no role for me as the Director General in the investigation, given that the Permanent Secretary was playing the role that she did.
Okay, I appreciate what you were saying, that in normal times, mm-hmm. that in your previous role, you wouldn't be involved in HR investigations, but in this instance, your staff were involved, but you were cut out of the loop and they were reporting direct to the perm sec. Is that something you were comfortable with at the time?
It didn't cause me any concern. As the Permanent Secretary said in her evidence, and in a way as Mr. Caquette indicated earlier when he was talking about his own role, it was not unusual by any means for senior professional advisers within the government to report directly either to the Permanent Secretary or to other DGs. The Principal Finance Officer, for example, would quite often provide advice directly to my fellow DGs or to the Permanent Secretary. And as somebody who was not an HR specialist in this instance, there was no obvious value that I would add by checking their homework before they presented it to the Permanent Secretary or to other DGs. So, no, that didn't give me any difficulty. That was quite normal.
Okay, that's clear. And you were part of the Permanent Secretary's executive team and chair of the People Board. And you said something which struck me as quite unusual in your written evidence. You made a point of saying that you had no involvement in the Permanent Secretary's all staff communication. I'm just curious as to why you felt the need to say that. It seems like a inconsequential thing to say, but civil servants are never inconsequential.
So I think what I was intending to convey there was that the People Board had a role in the government which was essentially about the corporate governance of the organisational development strategy. I think it occurred to me in drafting it that anybody who was not familiar with the corporate governance of government might not unreasonably think that the People Board, because of its name, might have been involved in the harassment procedure or in clearing all staff communications or something like that. So I included that to make clear that the People Board didn't have a role like that and indeed was not involved in any way in these proceedings.
Okay, and my next point, and my apologies if you've covered this with Margaret Mitchell, it's been a long morning, Ms. Davidson. But around the 19th of December, you were advised that there was material found that had not previously been identified. This was for the purpose of the judicial review. Mm-hmm. Who advised you of this and how? What was it? Did you say it was Nicola Richards in the context of supervision or a meeting with her?
So I can't recall precisely who alerted me to that fact, but certainly I was, but it wouldn't have been Nicola Richards because Nicola Richards was away on holiday by that point. So it may have been the legal directorate, it may have been the permanent secretary's office, I think possibly the latter. There was clearly, as one would expect, a degree of concern about the fact that documents were turning up late in the process. This clearly caused concern to the individuals, caused concern to the legal advisers. And I think it's likely in that context that I would have been advised. And given that Nicola Richards was on holiday, I think it's most likely that it either was from the Permanent Secretary's office or from someone in SGLD.
Okay, thank you. And earlier in the year, you had already requested advice from SGLD as some of your staff were going to have to give evidence at the Commission. What did this advice cover?
So I think it was actually just a few days prior that I had sought that advice, certainly no more than a week or so. I think Mr. Caquet, if I heard him correctly, said earlier that a commission of diligence is a relatively unusual process, and none of my colleagues who had been cited to attend had ever been involved in this before. As one might expect, there was a degree of anxiety about what was involved in going to give evidence in that format, and I therefore asked the litigation team in SGLD if they would provide some additional information for colleagues about, I think, some very practical things about what they might be asked, in what capacity they were there giving evidence, who would be present, and so on. It was that kind of advice.
Okay, and at any point were your staff advised about how to do proper searches for documents to ensure that the right information was available at the right time?
Certainly my understanding would have been that that advice would have been provided from the outset by the litigation team in SGLD, either directly or via the coordination function that Mr. Caquet referred to in the Permanent Secretary's office. I think that it became clear over time, and particularly towards the end of December, that searches had not been as comprehensive as they might have been, and therefore I think one might draw conclusions about whether the questions had been posed as clearly or as comprehensively at the outset as they should have been. But certainly my understanding is that SGLD would have provided that advice and that people would have been searching according to particular questions asked of them, okay, some of which were informed by the lawyer-to-lawyer correspondence that was happening at the time.
Okay, and the judicial review timeline, in your written evidence, you said that it could be interpreted that you had direct communications with counsel between the 21st and the 29th of December, but you didn't, and you've asked SG to clarify that. What communications and when did you have at all with counsel?
I had none at all.
Okay.
And that was why I queried that, because I didn't recognise it.
Okay, and were you cited on any legal advice?
No. So I guess as far as I can recall, I was cited on no legal advice as the judicial review was proceeding. For the purposes of enabling me to collate the report to the Permanent Secretary at the end of December, I was cited on the legal advice which was relevant to the section of that report which SGLD contributed to, or at least I was cited on the components of some of that legal advice. And that would have been, but that was all related to that fairly late stage. I don't recall seeing any legal advice earlier in the process.
Okay. So we know that on the around the 21st of December, the Permanent Secretary asked you, and I think this is your word in your written submission, that you were asked to urgently collate various strands of advice received from senior professional advisers. Can you tell us why this was urgent? It may seem like I'm asking the obvious, but it would be important to hear your understanding. Why was this urgent?
So again, I was looking at the timeline supplied to the committee to refresh my memory on this period. Clearly, the commission had taken place on the... The second day of the commission had taken place on the 21st of December, and on that day as well, the timeline reminds me that Judith McKinnon had found additional documents which had been handed to the petitioner's senior counsel, and that there was a consultation that day with counsel. And while I wasn't privy to the discussions that took place at that at all, or the legal considerations, it was clear that this triggered for the Permanent Secretary a need to take stock on where the case was, and to take stock fairly urgently. There was another commission date set down. I forget if it's in the information. I'm sure it is here somewhere. But there was a commission date set down for either the very end of December or the very beginning of January, and the judicial review itself was due to start in January. So, I think looking at all of that, it feels fairly self-evident that if the Permanent Secretary needed to take stock, that needed to happen quickly.
Okay, so why you? Because you're out the loop. You've been cut out of the loop in terms of the investigation and the judicial review process. So why is she coming to you?
So it was not in any way unusual for the Permanent Secretary to ask one of her Directors General to carry out a particular task for her. That's something that we all did from time to time. By recollection, actually, it could have been one of a number of us. I remember a discussion in the Permanent Secretary's office where both I and one of my fellow Directors General were present when the discussion about commissioning this report took place. I can't now remember precisely why it fell down on my side. I think, to be honest, it may have been that I was due to be at home over Christmas and therefore had some more flexibility. So that was that was the context in which I was asked to do it. It may well have been, although again I can't recall, and it was the Permanent Secretary's decision to commission me. But it may well have been the fact that I hadn't been close to the detail was seen by her as being an asset in terms of being able to impartially pull together the advice that she needed.
Okay, so unlike some of your other colleagues, you were in the Maldives. So would it not have been more the norm for someone from SGLD to be pulling all of this together?
Had the Permanent Secretary purely been looking for legal advice, then yes, I think she would normally have gone to the Director of Legal Services. It could be the fact that she wanted to have financial advice as well, and of course the Chief Financial Officer sat within my area of responsibility. But again, as I say, it might be that she wanted the benefit of somebody who had not been as close to the matters that she was seeking advice on to pull it together. That meant she asked me. You'd have to ask her precisely what it was. That was my understanding at the time.
Appreciate that. And so you provide a report to the Permanent Secretary, and you state in your written submission that in that report you make no recommendations. But nonetheless, the Permanent Secretary comes to the view to concede the case. Now, we understand all about extensive legal privilege in this committee, but can you give us an insight into, you know, the content other than the headlines in your report, that there was a section on finance, section on legal advice, and section on handling? Your report may have had no recommendations, but it's clearly made an impact on the Permanent Secretary.
So my recollection, and again partly prompted by listening to Mr. Caquet earlier this morning, was that the component of that report, which was about legal advice, would have reflected what he was conveying, which was that a point had been reached where, I forget the exact terminology that he used, but a point had been reached where prospects of success were now looking very slim. I'm not saying those were words we used, but that was clearly what was being conveyed. And certainly the financial advice that was given would have reflected that legal assessment. It was the bringing together of those that was intended to enable the Permanent Secretary to take effectively a formal decision about how she wished to proceed.
Okay, I mean, that's quite a process-driven answer, and I can say that with respect. But let me put it another way. So, Scottish Government are pursuing a course of action. They are on the train lines, and they're heading in a very set direction, and we are told, we're informed by legal advice every step of the way. But it's you who provides a report and then the train is brought to a screeching halt. How can that be explained?
So I think it's important for me to be clear that the report didn't contain my personal assessment of the legal advice or financial advice. I was going to say merely, but that maybe understates the importance of the document, but I was putting together in one place for the Permanent Secretary to assess the advice from lawyers that had been reached by that point, along, as I say, with other points for consideration. And therefore, I wouldn't want to in any way suggest that it was something unique that I had said that led the Permanent Secretary to reach the conclusion that she did. The advice that was in the document reflected SGLD's presentation of the legal advice at that point.
Okay, so you're collating everything in the one place. So, can you see, you know, at what point did legal advice change? Are you able to pinpoint that?
So it was clear, and again, I'm going to rely on recollection here and what's in the timeline, that a combination of the substance of the documents which Judith McKinnon had identified later on, and the timing of finding those, had led to a reassessment of the prospects for the case. In order, so I was not even myself close enough to all the legal process to that date to fully necessarily understand how that was the case. I think you needed to be able to slot that understanding into an understanding of how the pleadings had developed over time, which I hadn't been close to and hadn't seen, and indeed didn't see at the time of producing this report. But clearly, both the timing of the production of these additional documents and the contents of them were such that they had led the lawyers to have the types of concerns that Mr. Kakett set out for the committee earlier today.
Okay, and my final question, convener, is, I mean, it's a matter of public record that the court found the Permanent Secretary's decision report letter unlawful in respect of, action that was taken in the circumstances which were perceived as unfair and tainted by apparent bias. I wonder, Ms. Davison, whether you were surprised by that finding of the court. And given that you were involved in two exercises around lessons learned, both in terms of the investigation and in terms of the judicial review, I do appreciate that both of these lessons learned exercises were halted. But you must, even with the benefit of 2020 hindsight, have an impression here.
So I think I'd want to be clear in relation to the lessons learned exercise that, as you identified, particularly the second one of those in relation to the procedure, that there was not an opportunity for that to make any significant progress at all at the time that I was involved in it. So was I surprised by the terms of the concession? I suppose not at that time, because I had seen that final stage of evidence which was developing towards the towards the point of concession. And of course, the Court of Session itself never took a view on that, because the case was conceded. Taking the whole process together, was I surprised that it ended at that point? In other words, that had been the case. Yes, I was, but I think that was in the context of not having been close to the neither to the investigation nor to the process of the judicial review. And I don't think there's really anything more I can add to that.
And bearing in mind, you commenced work to start lessons learnt exercises twice. You know, what was there anything that was learnt in the short term?
So the first lessons learned exercise that I referred to in my written statement was intended to be the lessons learned exercise that I think is provided for in paragraph 11 of the procedure, which requires the Permanent Secretary at the conclusion of an investigation to see whether there are any lessons to be learned for the organisation arising from the matters that were under consideration. So I began to draft that. Of course, it's important to remember that that was during the summer before any of these matters were in the public domain or indeed were known in the organisation beyond a very, very small number of people. It quite quickly became clear that it was difficult to comment in a lessons learned exercise on procedures that might have been inadequate in particular parts of the organisation without leading to the identification of where those things had taken place and therefore risking identifying the complainers. So that was one of the issues that made us pause on that. But then actually very quickly, the instigation of the judicial review proceedings themselves meant that it did not feel appropriate to be learning lessons from events which were themselves then very publicly being challenged.
So forgive me, I understand that the point you're making about process and you detail all that in your written submission. I suppose what to cut to the chase, what I was asking was, at the time, in the immediate aftermath, was anything learnt?
So my recollection of the lessons learned exercise, the one that we're talking about at the moment, not the one about the procedure, was that it led us to consider whether gaps that had been identified by the complainers in HR processes at the time, so the reasons that they'd given for why they felt they couldn't come forward at the time, we looked at whether we felt that there had been progress over the years since then, because there were, I think that was either 2 or 3 years prior to what we were doing. So we satisfied ourselves that there were now mechanisms in place for people in that area of the office to raise complaints that were significantly better than those that had been in place at the time. We looked at the people survey results for that part of the office, which were significantly better than they had been at the time of the alleged events taking place. And we, I think, identified some potential enhancements still further for ways in which people in that area of the office could be supported. That's my recollection of it. So those were very much about learning lessons from events which had happened around 2014, if I remember correctly, as opposed to more contemporary events.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Just before I move to Alison Johnson, Murdo Fraser has indicated one supplementary to something that was said. Murdo Fraser.
I've got a couple of supplementaries, Convener, but if I ask those, I won't need to come back in later. Would that help?
Well, that sounds like a good deal.
Would that be a good compromise? Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, Ms. Davidson. Can I just ask a couple of questions around this issue of the instruction from the Permanent Secretary on the 21st of December? We know that the Permanent Secretary was involved in the oversight group that had been established around the judicial review. Mm-hmm. Why do you think, or did she explain to you, why it was necessary then to get another opinion on this? Would she not have had all this information available to her as part of that group that she was a member of?
So, again, I think you would need to ask the Permanent Secretary about that. She was asking me as a senior colleague to ensure that that was brought together in a way that would be apt for her to take a decision. And she may have concluded that it was appropriate to ask one of her most senior team to do that. But again, you would have to ask her, I think, precisely for her reasoning.
Okay, thank you. Well, we have the Permanent Secretary coming in, so we can pursue that. And she gave you this instruction on the 21st of December. Mm-hmm. I hope it didn't spoil your Christmas too much. Did she ask you to prepare this within a certain time frame?
I can't recall the specific time frame, but it would be unusual in such a commission not to specify when the advice was required by. So my guess is the fact that it was provided, I think, by the 20th of December suggests that that was the Commission
that
deadline.
That was the deadline. Okay, and my final question, Convener. You mentioned in your answers to Angela Constance that you were bringing together financial advice. Mm-hmm. Can you explain the relevance of that to this particular issue?
So accountable officers, and of course the Permanent Secretary is the principal accountable officer for the Scottish Administration, always have to have regard to a number of accountable officer tests in relation to, in relation to anything that they do, the formal delegations that allow money to be spent by the Scottish Administration require these things to be taken into account. So regularity, propriety and value for money is the formal way of describing those. And any accountable officer, whether at principal accountable officer level or anywhere else in the system, if considering a particularly knotty issue or contentious issue, would want to have regard to those accountable officer tests in relation to the decisions they were making.
But I can press you a little bit further. When you say the financial matters, are we talking about legal costs or is there something other than legal costs here?
My recollection was it would have been that it would be the legal costs. In other words, costs inherent in proceeding with the action. Yeah. Yes, these were all inherently related to the continued defence of the judicial review or otherwise.
Right. So you perhaps have had to provide an estimate of if the case had continued, what the additional costs might have been.
Again, I can't recall the detail of whether that was in it. I suspect that the advice from the principal finance officer, certainly would have been normal in such cases for the advice from the principal finance officer to say, you know, in continuing to spend public money in a case like this, these are the things to which you would wish to have regard.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Alison Johnson, please, and then Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon. I can't help but, on reading the evidence provided today, reaching a conclusion that your actions certainly seem to have been decisive in bringing matters to a close. Mm-hmm. So can you just elaborate on why you decided to take a more hands-on approach at the point that you did around the 20th of December mm-hmm. to directing senior officials in relation to the judicial review?
Again, my recollection, and I think the timeline speaks to this to a large extent, as indeed I think Mr. Caquet did, was that pressure was ramping up considerably over this time. There was a very small number of people, as Mr. Caquet said, involved, or a relatively small number of people involved, who were being asked to look for further documents, who were being asked to give evidence in a formal legal process. And that was all being done under immense time pressure. People were very, very pressurised and I think it's fair to say anxious and stressed by that process. And not all of those people were within my area of formal responsibility, but some of them were. And it felt therefore important to me to provide whatever help and support I could in order to enable them to discharge their responsibilities appropriately as part of the legal process, but also as part of my duty of care to them as Scottish Government staff. So, for example, asking SGLD to provide additional support to them and advice to them was in line with that. And I think that may well be, again, I can't recall precisely why I was asked to issue the email that I refer to in my written evidence, seeking to be very clear about the nature of searches. But again, I think it may well have been because of my seniority, that it was helpful for people to get that very clear line from a senior official, albeit that the content of that email would have come and been drafted for me by the lawyers.
On the nature of searches and the need to be very specific in order to obtain mm-hmm. optimal information, were IT specialists involved or people, did you have any assistance from those who would really know how to get mm-hmm. to the bottom? Sometimes I struggle myself with searches. So there's, there are those who have great expertise in this. Did you seek such advice or input?
So at the point of issuing that email, the purpose of that, as I recall, was to be very clear about where people should be searching. So, for example, to be clear for the avoidance of doubt, I don't know whether this was made clear before, but for the avoidance of doubt, that things like WhatsApp messages and everything, all of those things should be brought out. Later on, and I think it's in the, down as being on the 24th of December in, yes, that's right, in the Scottish Government timeline, our IT specialists were involved. I was involved in bringing them in. Digital was also within my area of responsibility. And as Mr. Caquette said earlier, there had previously, as I understand it, been concern about bringing more people into searches because of the very sensitive nature of what was being searched. And I recall I was part of a discussion on or around the 24th of December, which recognised that we would have to bring IT specialists in from the IT team. At that point, there was an agreement of some very specific terms that they should be asked to search for, mm-hmm. and specific mailboxes and H drive files that they should be asked to search in. And I think, although I can't specifically recall, but I think it would have been correct that as the senior officer responsible for the digital directorate, I would have been asked to sanction that search, because clearly searching all of people's information was a fairly sensitive thing to do. So I think I did sanction that on around the 24th.
And did you feel frustrated that that level of specificity hadn't been suggested earlier?
It was... I certainly recognised that the... So the reason I'm hesitating is because I don't know precisely what was specified earlier on, so I can't say for certain. I think I shared the general frustration that documents were becoming... were being found late in the process, which clearly assisted nobody involved. So, yes, there was a general frustration about that.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, just for absolute clarity, what prompted you to advise the Permanent Secretary to concede the judicial review?
So, to be clear, I didn't advise her to concede. I provided the information and I didn't draw a conclusion. It was left to her. What I had been asked to do was to provide the information in a means that would enable her to take a decision to concede, so it was her decision.
And did she discuss that information with you?
I don't recall discussing the contents of it. I think there may have been a call which involved a number of people, principally legal advisers, following my submission on the 28th. And again, I think the timeline suggests that the timeline suggests that on the 31st of December, the Permanent Secretary requested additional legal advice. Mm-hmm. I think that request may have been made in the context of a call, which a number of people were on, not simply myself, where she was feeding back her thoughts, her reaction to the report that I had given her, and on the basis of which she requested additional advice. That advice was not from me or passed through me, and my recollection is I didn't have any further role in providing information to her at that time.
Okay, and finally, convener, can you confirm the basis on which the Scottish Government conceded the case?
So my understanding of the basis was, I don't have it to hand, but was as Mr. Caquette stated at the end of his evidence when he read out the basis of the concession. That was my understanding. As I say, I was not close to all the detail of it, and I couldn't attest to the legal arguments. So my understanding is the same as anyone reading those words.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Alex Cole-Hamilton and then Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, convener. Good afternoon, Ms. Davidson. I should say for the record that Ms. Davidson and I have a long-standing professional friendship from times we worked together while I was in the voluntary sector. I'd like to start by asking you a semi-personal question, Ms. Davidson. I think in my earshot, certainly, you'd been talked about as a potential future permanent secretary yourself. So a lot of people were surprised when you left government in 2019. Can I just ask, was your departure from government in any way linked to your feelings about this episode and how things have been handled?
Absolutely not.
Okay, that's absolutely fine. Can I move on to your reference in your written advice about citations around the 17th of December, and that a number of staff had been issued citations to appear before the Commission. I think it would be very helpful if you could provide us, perhaps in writing at a future date, your recollection of who exactly was cited to appear. But I have one specific question. To your recollection, was the First Minister's principal private secretary, John Summers, cited to appear before the Commission?
not by my recollection, and I think in the Scottish Government timeline on page 17 in relation to 17th of December, it sets out those who received citations. I'm pausing now because it does not say that that's a comprehensive list.
Right.
But certainly, had you asked me who I'd have called had received mm-hmm. citations, the names that I would have recalled would have been those okay. listed against the 17th of December.
The reason I asked for your recollection was if there was any variance from the list that we've been provided. Yeah. So that's
not by my recollection.
You don't need to follow that up, in which case. I'd like to follow. A number of people have already asked about the report that you were commissioned to write, I think on the 21st of December. Mm-hmm. Urgently so. And just to clarify, that the urgency, the catalyst for that report mm-hmm. was a recognition that the balance of success against the arguable case was now so poor that there was a pressure to concede. Is that right?
So the reason I'm hesitating is because I don't recall that that was the way that the commission was presented to me. In
right.
other words, I don't recall that the presentation or the commission said, as you described it, this is now so poor. Can you kind of help us to concede, as it were? But it was clear to me that a point had been reached where clearly, on the basis of what had come to light, the lawyers were saying, or rather, whatever the permanent secretary had heard. Presumably, but I don't know for certain, in that
yeah.
consultation on that date, led her to think, I need to take stock now.
Okay.
And again, I think from what one knows in the background, the thing that one would want to take stock on in her role as permanent secretary would be the prospects for success.
So if I can read from your written submission, you talk of the project that you finished on the 28th of September. You say, I submitted this to the Permanent Secretary on or around the 28th of September. My understanding is that following receipt of this advice, I believe after having obtained further legal advice, mm-hmm. Permanent Secretary concluded the petition should be conceded. Now, I infer from that the catalyst to your report was legal advice, and I'm not asking you to go into the legal advice for obvious reasons, but that's I think what strikes me from this. I just wonder, was your report there to help the Permanent Secretary break some kind of impasse, that perhaps that she was at loggerheads with legal counsel as to whether to continue with the case, and that the fact that after receiving this that she went back to legal counsel either to say, no, I think we should continue, or vice versa?
No, that wasn't. I had no impression of that at all.
Okay.
And it would be quite normal in the way of doing things for a permanent secretary, or indeed anyone senior having to take a decision, to ask for something formal to enable them to take that decision, partly for the record, but also so that they could satisfy themselves that in a fast-moving situation they had properly considered all of the matters that should be before them.
I understand. And I think my final question then, Convener, just moving on to your being commissioned to look at paragraph 10 in the immediate aftermath and the lessons learned. And obviously we know that was taken out of your hands, so to speak, with the commissioning of the Dunlop review. Mm-hmm. Did you have a chance or did you make any recommendations for immediate remedy mm-hmm. to the policy? To put it another way, did you recognise that leaving it unchanged would present a barrier to potential future complainers coming forward, mm-hmm. given what had happened with the judicial review?
So I didn't have an opportunity to even make the progress, even to scope the review. I think it was within a day or something of this being suggested that the decision was taken that, in fact, this should be done externally. So to the first part of your question, the answer is no. Again, it's hard to recall precisely, but I certainly do remember that there were discussions about what would happen in the eventuality of another complainer coming forward. Not that was known. Not that there was any particular instance in view, and a recognition that if somebody else did make a complaint under the procedure, then the lessons which had been possibly not learned in the sense of writing them down, but clearly learned by everybody who'd been through the previous 12 months would have to be taken into account in decisions such as the appointment of the investigating officer and the way that the investigation was carried out.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Jackie Bailey, please, and then Maureen Watt.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, or indeed good afternoon at this point. On the 19th of December 2018, further material turned up that hadn't been previously identified, and you were asked to intervene. Can I ask, who was responsible for the collation of that material in the 3 months prior to your intervention?
So my understanding was that the responsibility lay both with the litigation team in the Scottish Government Legal Directorate and with the point of coordination in the Permanent Secretary's office.
Who is the point of coordination in the Permanent Secretary's office?
The Permanent Secretary's private secretary.
Who was that at the
time? That was below SCS level, so I don't think the Scottish Government has released their name.
Okay, thank you. So you were then asked to compile the emergency report we've heard about on the 21st of December. Given that you didn't make recommendations, you didn't have meetings with council, do you understand why your report has been withheld from the committee?
No, I don't. And I understand that the Scottish Government has withheld it, but that would be a matter for them. I don't.
Okay, so
they told me that was the case, but I don't know why.
I'm trying to understand if there were no recommendations, there was no legal advice contained in it. It was a narration of the facts.
It contained legal advice. It contained advice that was given to me by SGLD, which they would have obtained from a number of sources.
Okay.
Pardon me.
Did your report touch on the timeline of when the information in relation to Judith McKinnon's dual role of both supporting the complainants and being the investigating officer was first revealed?
My recollection is that it would have contained advice from Legal Directorate about what was contained in the documents that Judith McKinnon had turned up late in the process. If I knew, I can't recall precisely how they bore on the overall timeline, but the legal advice in the report would have said something about the import of those late productions.
Did you have access to external legal advice that was provided to the Scottish Government?
Not directly to me, but if there was any external legal advice, it would have been reflected in what Mr. Caquette gave me.
Okay, so based on what Mr. Caquette knew, is there a timeline for when external legal opinion was taken in relation to the role of the investigating officer?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure how... Could you just be clear about the question?
Sure, I'm trying to establish at what point external legal advice was taken and how that was reflected to you in relation to Judith McKinnon's role as the investigating officer. You'll have seen the conversation about 19th of October, 23rd of October, that kind of thing.
Yeah, so I don't know when that was. I don't know when that was obtained.
Okay. Given that we heard Paul Caquette say that, you know, there were daily meetings with the Permanent Secretary's office, were you surprised you were asked to do this report, given your lack of involvement up to that point?
No, as I say, it wasn't unusual for the Permanent Secretary to ask a DG on her behalf to do a bit of senior work like that. So, no, I wasn't.
Okay.
I wasn't particularly surprised.
Okay. After you submitted your report on the 28th of December, what follow-up was there?
So, as I said in response to Ms. Johnson's questioning, I recall a telephone conference call, which I think, and again, to the jog in my memory by looking at the Scottish Government timeline, I think that would have been on the 31st of December. And again, to the best of my recollection, that was the opportunity for the Permanent Secretary to feed back to a number of people, including her legal advisers and others, what her response and reaction was to the advice that I'd given her. Again, my recollection, and it's reflected in the time entry for the 31st of December, was that she actually had some further questions, which were essentially about the legal advice, and she asked for some additional legal advice. I can't recall precisely what that was, and I see the Scottish Government was applying LPP to it anyway. It wasn't advice that was sought from me, or indeed that I think I saw.
Could I ask who was on that conference call?
I can't recall. I can't recall. I think the likelihood would have been that Paul Caquette would have been on it. I think it's likely that her permanent secretary would have been on it, possibly a communications advisor. But
Not the Lord Advocate?
I honestly can't recall. I would be misleading you to suggest one way or the other. I can't recall.
That's a shame. Okay. You say that in January 2019, you were asked to review paragraph 10 of the procedure. Mm-hmm. Why just paragraph 10? Because there are other grounds in the petition.
Mm-hmm. My recollection is the Scottish Government only conceded on the matters relating to paragraph 10, and therefore the Scottish Government, as far as I can recall, took the view that there was nothing else to be reviewed at that point. Whether they've changed their mind since, I don't know, but that was the position at that time.
Okay. Can you make an observation that why were you being asked to do this in January, 2 months after it was known there was a problem? It's a bit slow.
I think, so there were... Again, you'd have to ask the Permanent Secretary that. But that I was being asked to do it in the light of the fact that the judicial review had been conceded, and clearly at that point, the Scottish Government, the Permanent Secretary, had conceded that the application and interpretation of paragraph 10 required to be reviewed.
Okay. Has anything happened, in your knowledge, to paragraph 10 since you provided that report in January 2019, or does it remain the same?
So I didn't provide a report at all. As I said, I didn't. Okay. Within days, if not hours, of my being asked to review it, the decision was taken that, in fact, it would be more appropriate for that to be external. Okay. And I don't know what's happened since then.
Okay. We heard from Paul Caquette, and this is my final question, convener, that this was the PermSex procedure. She drove the policy development. She clearly had a key role in implementation. Did she drive the judicial review process too?
So she was the respondent to the judicial review process.
I mean, internally, was she the one that was kind of everybody was reporting to?
So if there was a client, as it were, in the judicial review process, then the Permanent Secretary was the client, yes.
Okay.
Often discharged through her office for obvious reasons, given other business. But yes, she was the client.
Sure. But she was the one you reported to. She was the one commissioned the report from you. So she was the one in charge.
Yes, correct.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Can I just ask for the clarity of the official report? In answer to a question to Jackie Bailey there, Ms Davidson, about that call, you said her permanent secretary.
Sorry, her private secretary. Sorry,
you did, yes. You meant her private
secretary. I meant her private secretary.
Thank
sorry,
you very
yes.
much. Margaret Mitchell.
Could I ask you if you're aware of the offer of arbitration to deal with the dispute over the competency and legality of the procedure?
Not at the time, certainly not as I recall, no.
So you were never aware of it by anyone?
Not contemporaneously, as far as I recall. Clearly, I know about it now, but I don't recall being aware of it at the time the offer was made, and nor would there be any reason for me to have been, because I wasn't involved in the legal discussions.
Do you know when you did become aware of it?
No, I don't recall, but it could have been as recently as through the evidence provided for this committee.
All right.
But I can't say for certain.
So there would be absolutely no possibility of you knowing who took the final decision to reject arbitration?
No.
Right.
No,
thank
I wasn't
you
involved in that at all.
Maureen Watt.
Thank you, Convener. Afternoon, Ms Davidson. You will have heard me ask Paul Coquette about how often and by what means any ministers were kept abreast of what was happening on all these legal discussions. Are you aware, or were you copied into any briefings that went to ministers? And are you aware, for example, whether your report was shared with ministers, or was it purely the Permanent Secretary?
So I wasn't copied into, and nor would have expected to be aware of any briefings going to ministers during the process of the judicial review. My recollection, and this would have been normal, was that my advice to the Permanent Secretary would not have been copied to ministers. What she then did with it, you'd have to ask her, but I certainly was not aware that my report per se went to ministers, and it was not directed to them.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Ms Stevenson, you just answered a question from Margaret Mitchell about arbitration. Can I ask, were you aware of the offer of mediation when that was made?
I don't recall. I may have been. but I certainly wasn't involved in any decision about how it should be handled. I may have been aware at the time, Nikki Richards, pardon me, may have updated me as part of our routine management meetings, but I couldn't say with certainty, and I certainly wasn't involved in handling it.
Thank you. In your submission to the committee as well, under the handling of complaints part, in fact, you said that in January 2018, Nicola Richards informed you that two of the individuals who'd previously raised concerns were likely to make a complaint. And you said that she, in a previous catch-up meeting, she'd discussed the appointment of the investigating officer with you. And I wonder, did she say to you who that investigating officer was?
Yes, she did. She told me, as I said in my written evidence, as part of a normal catch-up, that she was... Should the things which were being treated as concerned at that time, should they ultimately evolve into formal complaints out of the procedure, that she was considering appointing Judith McKinnon as the investigating officer.
And were you aware at any point that Judith McKinnon had previous involvement?
Again, by recollection, as I think it's likely that I would have been aware of some previous involvement. Mm-hmm. There is no reason at that time for that per se to have given me any concern, but yes, I think I would have been aware.
Right. Also, and I can't remember who you were answering to earlier, you said about having to undertake another check about documentation for the judicial review, mm-hmm. that there hadn't been clear advice given before about what information was required. Who had given that advice before?
So my assumption is that advice about how to conduct searches in relation to a legal process would come from the litigation team in the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, either directly to individuals who were required to search or indirectly via the coordination point to the Permanent Secretary's office. As Mr. Caquette set out earlier, the grounds for the judicial review clearly were evolving, so I would imagine that a number of requests for documentary checks might have been required. I don't know. I don't know how many there were. I wasn't close to it. But that's what the process that I would expect to have taken place was.
Mm. And can I ask if you were shocked at what was found by this second trawl that was instigated by you?
I wasn't close enough to the process to be able to slot that into an understanding of the pleadings, mm-hmm. such as that I would have a reaction one way or the other. Mm.
And finally from me, and I don't see anyone else indicating, I noticed you also said at the beginning of this session that it was fairly normal for you as DG not to have been involved in issues of human resources, and that would be very much left to Nicola Richards and her team. Is that normal within the setup of the civil service, where a DG would be separated from day-to-day workings at director level?
So the model that the Scottish Government has followed since 2007 is one that we describe as a director-led model. So directors do have both formal delegations of quite significant financial and other responsibility and a large degree of operating autonomy on a day-to-day basis within their areas of responsibility. There are, I forget how many, but there are a large number of directorates, and I wasn't the only DG who had a large number of portfolio areas within my area of responsibility. So in practical terms, that was entirely normal, whether in policy areas or in areas of professional specialism. Although I think it's fair to say that in areas of professional specialism, there was a particularly high degree of autonomy. As a DG, I was not qualified HR specialist or a qualified finance specialist or any of the other areas of responsibility in my area. So the role that I had was to support my directors and to seek assurance from them that the way in which they were going about their jobs and discharging their responsibilities was what I would expect. So I would ask questions to check that they were thinking things through properly and going about them properly. But it would be, and again, my fellow DGs would do exactly the same, but it would be entirely normal for them to have a high degree of autonomy in discharging their functions.
Would it also be normal for these directors at that level to report directly to the Permanent Secretary on specifics, bypassing their own DG?
Yes, particularly on corporate issues. Indeed, I think I mentioned in my opening statement that my role was only created at the point that I took it up. Mm-hmm. Now, there'd been a variety of different ways of handling corporate functions over the years before that, but quite often the heads of corporate functions reported directly to the Permanent Secretary without anyone in between. And when the DG role was created, it was recognised that there were some matters, particularly very sensitive senior staffing issues and issues where advice had to be provided to the Permanent Secretary in her role as Principal Accountable Officer, where quite normally directors would provide that directly to the Permanent mm-hmm. Secretary.
Yeah, you said that in HR terms, you're not an HR professional, wouldn't be expected to be. But from my recollection, the director's not an HR specialist either.
Not at the moment, no. But Judith McKinnon, who was responsible for the bit of the People Directorate, which required specialist HR expertise, was highly mm-hmm. qualified in that respect.
Mm-hmm. This is a very open question, but it has been asked by colleagues of other people. Hindsight is a wonderful thing. Mm-hmm. Looking back, do you regret that the structure of the organisation is such that you didn't have a more direct role in this?
As somebody who was neither bringing specialist HR expertise nor specialist legal expertise, I think from my understanding of the process, which is as I've set out, necessarily limited, it's hard to see what additional what I could have brought that was additional to that, other than just another pair of eyes.
Okay, if no one else has any other quick questions? No, thank you very much, Ms. Davidson, for your evidence today. And that concludes the public evidence session, and we'll now move into private session.